Here is our 4A state championship ball game, matching the Geneseo Maple Leafs and Metamora Redbirds. And this is where they come from. Geneseo out of Henry County, an enrollment of 890. Metamora, town population of 3398. In Woodford County, a school enrollment of 985. And you can look at all those population numbers you want. But guess what? Nobody's home.
Jeff, what do you think? Anybody there today?
There's nobody in either town tonight.
Nobody. Home. I think they turned the street lights off there.
Pretty much did, yes.
This is football all the way. I mean, these two communities, we see Geneseo, Metamora, you see the graphics. We could have done that the last 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. This is what it's all about in these two towns.
You go into either one of these two towns on a Friday, Saturday during the playoffs, you don't go by a house, right. You don't go by a yard, a business that doesn't say, let's go Redbirds. Let's go Maple Leafs, Green Machine, anything. I mean, this is football tradition.
It really is, and it's just not – the season never ends. You know, after this game tonight, they're going to start talking about next year right away. You know, you hate to say that, but that's the way it is. And, you know, it's still small-town football, but, you know, it about as intense as you can get. And, you know, it says a lot about both coaches. It says a lot about both programs. Not only do you go back 10 years for these programs, you're going back 20 and 30 years for these programs.
No doubt.
Let's talk about, first of all, the Geneseo Maple Leafs. They come into this ballgame a little bit unheralded coming into this. It struggled at various times this year, survived some games in the playoffs. But here's a team that will ride it right on through. They have so far.
Yeah, I'd say Geneseo came through the playoffs being an underdog in a number of their playoff games. Certainly last week and then the rest of the playoffs outside of their round one game, I would say that they came into the playoffs as an underdog. What they've done in the playoffs is play great defense and run the football. They've been running the same offense at Geneseo since Coach Reed was there and had his magnificent run long, long ago. Moved it on to the next coach, which in no doubt we're going to talk about, or our announcers are going to talk about, the father of Larry Johnson Jr., Larry Johnson Sr., who you could see on the sideline if you went down there right now helping his son coach. That same offense went to Augustana and had unbelievable success in the college playoffs there. So you're going to see tradition, you're going to see people that believe in what they do, and you're going to see kids really getting after running the football.
Well, we're going to talk about running the football in the trenches for these two teams. A big man up front that make it roll, make it happen. We'll take a look at the numbers for those in the trench numbers for Geneseo. Their offensive line at 6'1", 225. Metamora, obviously not as big. Their front five, 6 feet, 201 pounds. And these two teams are predicated on more than just size. That's why they have gotten where they have. And for Metamora, Jeff, here's a team that Pat Ryan, I think he has a reserve spot marked on the sideline.
Well, I got to tell you, the Thanksgivings at the Ryan house are probably a little different than other places. This would be Coach Ryan's seventh time here. That's unbelievable. And for him and his program to be here that many times, what a credit to him. Again, it's a run offense. We talked about it earlier tonight. This could be one of the fastest state title games that we've seen between Geneseo and Metamora running the ball as much as they do. But Aaron Peters, Metamora's fullback, unbelievable. He has 228 carries for 1,800 yards and 28 touchdowns. And so it's going to start with him, and also their quarterback, Mike Fay, does a great job of running their offense. One thing I do like with Metamora, all the experience they have back from last year's state title game.
All right, we're going to run, and then we're going to run a little bit more. But what do you see? How will this game play out other than it may be done in an hour and 45 minutes?
Well, I think it's really important that Geneseo establishes that they can move the football and run, and they need to play great defense and slow down the Metamora attack.
One thing, you know, I've talked about it before. We saw the fumbles all day long and momentum in that. And don't forget about special teams. I think that's always going to be a big part of any big game. And, I think it's going to be a great game between two great coaches.
How about it? Geneseo and Metamora, it's your 4A state championship game here in 2009. It could have been your championship game in 1989, but it's all coming your way. Next, as we get set, Lee Hall and Greg Bradshaw ready to bring it to you here on the IHSA TV network. Geneseo makes its ninth state finals trip, but first since 1993.
Best may be yet to come, the Class 4A title game between Metamora and Geneseo. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our 4A title game. I'm Scott Lubber, your field reporter for tonight's action. Oh, these are two superpowers. You've got two teams that have won multiple championships over the years, two schools that have been here numerous times and finished second in the state. Which superpower is going to come out number one tonight? We're going to find out. For more on this matchup, let's go up to the booth to Lee Hall and Greg Bradshaw.
All right, Scott Lever, thank you very much. Greg Bradshaw, they were talking about it in between games. I don't think there are any two communities in this state of Illinois that mean football. Football means more to than Geneseo and Metamora. It's a classic showdown. I think Geneseo-Metamora, you think back to the great matchups in the 70s, and here they are again tonight.
Yeah, it's fitting that they're here, two of the best football programs in the state. But these are these teams. They're not the past. It's this team tonight against the other team. And we've got two good football teams, two good running offenses. We're going to see some bruising football tonight.
That's right. And it's a couple of teams maybe that people didn't think would be here. Metamora did not win their conference. They come in with a loss. Geneseo has gotten some breaks in the postseason to get here as well. Let's take a look at the road to Champaign. First for Geneseo. Went over Plano, Bishop McNamara, what a game that was, 26-24. They beat Mendota, and then Richmond Burton at home, at the home of the Green Machine. As for Metamora, they had some close calls too in the postseason as we take a look at their road to Champaign. Not much of a contest against Central Catholic or Champaign-St. Thomas More, but Breeze Modern Day, a whale of a ball game. And the game against top-ranked Rochester went down to the final play of the game. Rochester went for two with 3 seconds to play, and the Metamora defense stopped that play and earned themselves their third straight trip to state here.
Yeah, these teams haven't gotten here easily. They've played some hard football games. They're battle-tested. Now they're going head-to-head tonight. We got some great football players in tonight's game, Lee.
Yes, we do. It's all old school here tonight, Greg. And let's take a look at our key players for this ball game. First, for Geneseo, Jason Johnson, the senior running back.
It's fitting that the fullback from Geneseo be the key man on offense. He's 220 pounds of bruiser. He's got 876 yards, you can see there. Not a lot of touchdowns, but they establish him first. He's the key player on offense.
Absolutely, and then defensively, for Geneseo is Aaron Kotecki.
Aaron Kotecki, he's an all-stater. He's a great linebacker. You can see a good look at him right there. Only 195 pounds, but he plays bigger. Made a big stop last week on fourth down to get him in the championship game. He's a great football player.
You can hear the roar down below. Geneseo and Metamora have turned out in great numbers for this ball game. Let's take a look at the key players for Metamora offensively. It's number 47. He is the main man, Aaron Peters.
That's all right. He's another all-stater. Let's take a look at him right there. Another big 6 foot, 195 pound running back, 1,800 yards, 28. Look at his yards per carry. He's the key man on offense for Metamora. He lines up. They line up in the shotgun, but he gets the ball a lot.
He is one hard-nosed runner. And defensively for Metamora, their leading tackler is a defensive back, David Kenny. He's come up big in the playoffs as well on offense.
That's right. But he's going to have to come up quick from the defensive cornerback position, get good run support, because Geneseo is not going to put in the air very often. He's a good football player. He's going to have to play very, very tough and get on the line tonight.
Of course, today known as Black Friday because it officially starts the Christmas shopping season. This game might go quick enough for us to get out of here and get some Christmas shopping done before the stores close tonight. Both these teams going to rely heavily on the run. We've seen a little bit more passing from Metamora the last few weeks in the playoffs, but they are both run-first teams. And Pat Ryan says that's kind of a nice breath of fresh air when you see all the teams with the spread offense these days.
That's right. Well, these teams know how to run the football, but I wouldn't be surprised if the pass becomes key in this game. We might be saying at the end of this game it was the pass that made the difference, but again, these guys can really, really run the ball up front. It's the big boys up front that make a difference. You're going to see some great physical line play tonight from both sides.
Of course, Geneseo runs the age-old wing T, as we mentioned in our game earlier when we were talking about this ball game. Not much has changed Geneseo football in the last 50 years. The uniforms look the same. Pat Ryan says even the socks are the same. And the wing T offense hasn't changed either. So we will be seeing a lot of that from the Maple Leafs, a lot of run from Metamora tonight as well. Let's go to Jeff Fritzen, our PA announcer.
People to places. To sit and reach.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, here are the starting lineups for the Class 4A IHSA football championship game. First, from Geneseo, head coach Larry Johnson. And the Maple Leafs defense at end, number 85, Hunter Fears. A tackle, 59, Alex Anderson. Nose guard, number 54, Ryan Patterson. Tackle, number 68, Cole Riley. At in, number 31, Wes Cathcart. Linebacker, number 51, Mark Snodgrass. Linebacker, number 34, Aaron Kentucky. Defensive back, number 22, Colin Akers. Defensive back, number 41, Luke Lemke. Defensive back, number 32, Andrew Walters. And defensive back, number 21, Blake Krogert. Now introducing Metamora, head coach Pat Ryan. And the Redbirds offense at in, number 81, Austin Ford. At tackle, 57, Tyler Birch. Guard, number 51, Ian Zurcher. At center, 76, Chaz Brees. At guard, 52, Austin Lewandowski. Tackle, 73, Nick Willman. At in, number 40, Vince Fraboni. Quarterback, number 15, Michael Fay. Halfback, number 4, Grant Whittington. Halfback, number 13, Dan Burke. And in fullback, number 47, Aaron Peters.
All right, there you have it. There's tonight's starting lineups. Metamora won the toss. They will receive and work from our left to our right as we look at the field. There's some of the Geneseo faithful on hand. Boy, they are fired up. Let's take a look at Greg's keys to the game, brought to us by Country Financial. First for Geneseo, Greg.
Well, you can see there, eat the clock and score. They want to drive the ball. Three downs each time, get a first down, use the clock, get some points. Secondly, the backers blitz. They love to bring their inside linebackers on blitzes. You see Kentucky coming in all night, and they like to make big plays out of those blitzes. And then lastly, fumble frenzy. They have, Geneseo has forced 32 fumbles, Lee, this year, and they like to attack the ball to get turnovers. On Metamora's side, big play fake. We know that they can run the football, but their quarterback can make some great plays too, both with his legs and his arm, looking for big plays out of him. Jam up Johnson. They have to stop the fullback. They have to be able to stop Johnson on the run. Lastly, play the field. They need to play good field position. They got a great kicker in Brennan Van Meegem, and they can use field position to get an advantage tonight.
Luke Lemke will kick it off for Geneseo. The Maple Leafs come into this game 11-2, Metamora 12-1. Dan Burke back to field it at his own 2-yard line. The reverse to start things off. The give is to David Kenny. He's still on his feet near midfield and brings it back all the way to the 45-yard line. There is a flag down at the Metamora 15.
On the return, there is a penalty flag on the play.
Well, we talked about David Kenny being a key on defense. He gets, boy, oh, that's a tough call for Metamora. That's going to bring it all the way back to their own, well, the flag's at the 15. So that would put it about half the distance, right? 7.5.
Great execution on the reverse. Oh. Just using a little bit of extra hands on the one guy they needed to block. But it's going to come all the way back.
Illegal block in the back. Return team. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
It's marked at the 8-yard line. So Pat Ryan going to his bag of tricks very early in this ball game against Geneseo. Geneseo and Metamora met in the 1976 and the 1977 state championship games. Geneseo won them both. Pat Ryan was there. Larry Johnson Jr. was there. Michael Fay, the give to Aaron Peters to the left side. And he's out across the 10, good for 2 or 3 yards.
Here's a look at our starters on Metamora for offense. The offensive line, you just saw them, Burch, Zercher, Brees, Wilman, and Lewandowski, the big hosses up front for the Redbirds. Michael Fay struggled with injuries this year. Grant Whittington, Aaron Peters, the fullback, Dan Burke, Austin Ford, and Vince Fraboni. Second and seven for the Redbirds. Fay will spend most of the night in the shotgun with Peters right by his side. Fay keeps it. He's a strong runner. He's across the 15 out near the 20 where he's brought down and has a first down for the Metamora Redbirds, a pickup of nine for Michael Fay. Here's a look at the Geneseo starters on defense. Fears, Anderson, Patterson, Riling, and Cathcart up front. At the linebackers, it's Snodgrass and Aaron Kotecki. Keep an eye out for number 34 tonight. Defensive backs, Akers, Lemke, Walters, and Kroger. Michael Fay comes into this ballgame with 871 rushing yards, Greg. You talk about his arm and his legs, he can hurt you both ways. Garber in motion for the Redbirds. Give is to Peters. An ankle tackle by number 35. That's Jason Johnson in there for Geneseo, but Peters able to pick up some good yards even though he had him by the ankles.
Yeah, you're going to see that a lot. Just downhill running, gets his shoulder pads low, falls forward. Doesn't look like much, but it gets 6 to 7 yards. They're in short yardage in second down.
3,898 career yards coming in for the senior Aaron Peters for the Metamora Redbirds. Second and four. And it's Fay keeping it right up the middle, up across the 40-yard line, pickup of 15.
There's a good look at Michael Fay. He's a big kid. He's 6'2", 190 pounds. Makes the good fake there to Peters. No one on him because they're looking on Peters and makes a nice move. Good physical runner for a quarterback.
Well, you talk about the injuries. Michael Fay had a concussion in week one, an ankle in week two. Got hit, missed the second half of the Limestone game. Fumbles there. Looks like he fell on it himself.
Yeah, it looks like it's just a little bit of a low snap. It looks like he could have handled it, just fumbled it a little bit. It's lucky he got back on that ball. That's the thing, Geneseo finds ways to get big plays, and that's the kind of thing that they've been doing all season, particularly in the playoffs, taking advantage of the other team's miscues.
Second and 14. A miscue, but Metamora keeps the football. Fay keeps it that time, and he's met by a couple of Maple Leafs. Jason Johnson in on the tackle.
Jason Johnson playing a lot of linebacker now. He kind of teams up with Kotecki at the defensive linebacker position. That's two formidable linebackers in the middle of that defense.
There you see the scoring. A little bit of a change there in the playoffs. The Metamora defense, they face some throw first teams in the postseason, and that's not something they're used to seeing. Fay will throw this time, has a man. It's David Kenny again. He's the one that got all the way across midfield on the kickoff return that was called back. 9 yards for David Kenny.
You'll see just a quick screen out here. Number 21, Blake Kroger, comes up, makes a big tackle right here with a big hit to save of them getting the first down. Nice job by Blake coming up from a safety position and forcing a punt here from Metamora on their first drive. Great
Maple
play.
Maple Leafs hold. It's fourth and three. Bo Geyer in the punt. We don't have any punting numbers for Bo Geyer in the stats.
They don't punt very often. That's maybe why.
That's true.
Andrew Walters, 32 deep for Geneseo.
Walters and Lemke deep for the Maple Leafs. Kind of a little pooch kick, and Metamora hoping for a good roll, and they got it. Did they ever? All the way down to the 5-yard line. That's a 47-yard kick for Bo Geyer. The Maple Leafs will start deep in their own territory. Back after this on the IHSA TV network. Lee Hall, Greg Bradshaw, Scott Leber here in Champaign. Geneseo and Metamora, no score. The Maple Leafs will start. We'll see the old wing tee here, Greg.
Yeah, they know how to run it. and they're going to run it consistently and continually.
They give us to Johnson, and he's taken down after a gain of a couple of yards. And Larry Johnson Jr. says that he is the bell cow of our offense. Everything goes through him. We establish him first and then move on from there.
That's right. So you're going to get a lot of – the Metamora is going to see a heavy dose of Johnson early in the game, particularly to establish him. Then that opens up some of their other options to their offense.
The coach spells his name J-O-H-N-S-E-N. It's S-O-N for the running back, so they are not related. Here's a give on the kind of the end around the man in motion, Lemke, and he's brought down, but not before he gets a first down. Luke Lemke, his first carry of the game. 10-yard pickup.
Luke is their third leading rusher on the team. You're going to see just a fake inside. Lemke comes back on the counter and does a nice job keeping his balance. And he's the third leading rusher on the team, but he scores the most touchdowns. He has 21 touchdowns on the year, so he's their big play threat. But he's a good one.
Michael Atwell is the quarterback running the show back there, number 8. He gives to Johnson. He's met at the line of scrimmage, picks up a couple of yards before he's stopped by a host of Metamora defenders. And the clock may not stop in this game except for first downs, Greg Bradshaw.
That's true. That is true. You need to make the most of when you get the ball because you might not have it very often in this game.
Pat Ryan says the keys against the wing tee, stay disciplined, trust in your keys. You get a look at Larry Johnson Jr. Tackle once you get there. Giving up 3.5 yards isn't good enough because Geneseo is content to take that.
That's right.
Metamora wants to get them in second or third and long. Right now it's 2nd and 7. And here's, oh, what a great tackle by Kenny. David Kenny comes up and makes the stop. That was Colin Akers on the carry. Here's a look at the Geneseo starters on offense. Tommy Reese, Ethan Lawson, Nick Rubino, Mark Cothran, Andy Room up front for the Maple Leafs. Atwell at quarterback, Johnson, Akers, Lemke, Fears, and Lloyd. The offensive ends for the Maple Leafs. 3rd and 6. Well, it was 2nd and long, it's 3rd and long. This is what Metamora would like to do defensively tonight. The pitch is to Lemke. He's across the 25, 30, 35, 40. He's on his scoot past midfield. Is anybody gonna catch him? And a diving tackle. Boy, Dan Burke just saved a touchdown, but just barely. 70 yards, Luke Lemke on the scoop. My goodness, what a big run for Luke Lemke. Garber, Buettner, McKee, Wislick, Kemp up front for Metamora, Love, and Fraboni. Burke, McKinney, Mishler, and Kinney, the defensive backs for the Redbirds.
Great job on that little sweep play. We talked about Lemke being their big play guy. Makes a nice little cut and turns it into a huge gain. 1st and goal now from the 9-yard line.
70-yard pickup for Luke Lemke. This time it's Akers. And he'll get 2 or 3. Akers is a 5'7", 175-pound senior. Along with Atwell, it's Akers, Johnson, and Lemke, and those are the guys that kind of carry the load for the Maple Leafs. Big hit for Geneseo. Can they convert it into points here? 2nd and 7. Pitch to Lemke. He's got blockers. Goes down after a gain of a couple, maybe 3.
Nice job on defense there. Number 42, Sean McKee, came in and just good pursuit. It looked like there was going to be a hole there for Lemke. Thought he might rush to the corner, but tried to cut it up. But good pursuit by McKee and friends. Bring up 3rd now and 4 now.
Metamora, not a big defensive line at all. They really have to rely on technique and quickness. And so far, Geneseo getting the better of it here. Third and four. Should say third and goal. Here's Lemke, but a whistle before things got started. Geneseo takes their first timeout with 3:16 to go here in the first quarter. There was no flag. So the Maple Leafs will talk it over. Big third down and four play here, and Larry Johnson Jr. doesn't want to take any chances.
Yeah, what they did was they lined up in an extra lineman right and then pitched the ball back to left, and it wasn't open. They were just waiting for it.
Back after this local timeout. Third and goal, rather. Full house backfield there now. Akers brought down before he could get across the five-yard line. Nice play there by Sean McKee, the 6'1 senior, getting into the backfield and making the stop, bringing up fourth down.
David Kenny was in there too. Just a great job getting penetration into the backfield. They went unbalanced to the left, and ran to the left, and Metamora was waiting for it. There's a good look at there. There's Kenny coming in off of his cornerback spot, making a really good play.
Luke Lemke in for the field goal try. He is 4 of 5 this year. This is a 22-yard attempt. It's no good. Tough to tell from up here. It must have hooked left.
Yeah, missed it left. Looked like he just pulled it a little bit to the left.
Boy, and if you're a Metamora, you got to feel really good. I think you had to feel really good about yourself for forcing the field goal, even if you give up three there.
It goes back to that touchdown-saving tackle. Lemke looked like he was gone. The shoestring tackle saved it, and to get not even 3 points, 0 points. Great job by Metamora's defense.
That was Dan Burke, and let me tell you about Dan Burke. He is a man for all seasons. He's a man for all positions. He's played 6 positions this year for Metamora. They've had a ton of injuries, and he's done a little bit of everything. He played quarterback, he played fullback, he's played defensive back, he's played free safety. I mean, he's been all over the field, and he made a big play there for the Redbirds. Bit of a different look this time from the Redbirds. And the double handoff, and that is Burke with the carry that time. And that double handoff, we watched tape of Geneseo. That was really effective for Richmond Burton against Geneseo last week.
Yeah, it was, but they did a nice job staying home. That's a tough play to execute when you have 2 handoffs, but they did a nice job offensively, but it did not fool that Geneseo defense, and they were waiting for it.
Pick up a 4 for Dan Burke.
Get a chance when you're home. Watch those 2 inside linebackers there, 34 and 35. Watch their aggressive play. They really flow well with the ball.
He pitches to Burke this side. He's trying to get out to the corner. Gets to the 30, and he's brought down there. Big number 85, Hunter Fears, on the tackle. Burke close to a first down. It is a first down.
There's a little option out to the right. Makes a nice little cut here to get the first down. Nice job moving the chains. There's another angle at it. Burke makes a nice little move there. Gets 3 or 4 extra yards after first contact. So nice job there.
Burke's got 645 yards on the season coming in. He got 319 of those in 2 games. Bay keeps it himself. He's a big quarterback, but boy, can he run with the football, and he is out near the 45-yard line. Another Metamora first down. Faye, 871 rushing yards coming in. He picks up 13 that time.
Nice vision here. Watch the cutback right here, all the way back across. And then he breaks another tackle and carries the defender about 2 or 3 yards. Really good vision from Michael Faye running the football. You know, if you're watching at home, you see them in the shotgun, but they do not throw out of the shotgun very often. They run out of the shotgun. For the year, Michael Faye only threw 50 passes, but they go shotgun every play, similar to the Wildcat that you might see watching on Sundays.
He suffered that ankle injury in week 2, a high ankle sprain, and just in the last couple of weeks has he really kind of been back to his old self, according to Pat Ryan. There's Aaron Peters, their leading rusher, out near midfield. Pickup of 6 for Aaron Peters. Aaron's a 6'1", 195-pound senior. They call him Cyborg, his teammates do, because he runs like half man, half robot. He is has been fairly indestructible this year. He did miss one game with an injury. Last week was the first game he played in all year that he didn't total over 100 yards rushing. Rochester did a nice job on it. Faye to throw. And in and out of the hands of Austin Ford, the senior couldn't quite hang on as he kind of reached and stumbled for it. Just a little over his head.
Good fake by Faye. He's got him open on the flat, just a little bit high. Good effort there. He can't pull it in. You know, last week, you know, Michael Faye, when he passed, was very on target. And that was really the key to the game. It was a great football game back and forth. But when he pulled it and faked it and threw the football, he's very accurate with his passes.
7 for 7, 142 That's yards right. and a touchdown. Big third and fourth play here for the Redbirds from midfield. Peters the lone back. He gets the give. It'll be a first down and then some for Aaron Peters. Pick up of 7.
Last play, they brought their end over. They put all their backs on the right-hand side and just told Geneseo, we're coming to the right. Can you stop it? And they could not. And it's tough to stop Peters and company because they can really chew up the yards.
That is already the end of the first quarter. It went quickly. No score after one quarter, back after this local timeout. No score after one quarter. Lee Hall, former Northwestern quarterback, and Woodstock?
Woodstock.
Yes, 1983, right?
That's right.
That's right. He's been in this championship game before. Greg Bradshaw. The give to Peters. He just keeps that pile moving. He just keeps that pile moving. Take a look at the first half, first quarter stats, rather, brought to us by Menards. Say big money at Menards. 90 yards rushing for Geneseo. 70 of that came on that Luke Lemke carry.
That's right. You see 67 there, yards rushing for Metamora. Stats that we would have expected out of these two teams. Pretty even in that first quarter.
Second and four for the Redbirds. Here's the give to Peters. Has a nice little running alley there. If he gets into the linebackers in the backfield all night, it's going to be a long night for Geneseo. Pick up a 5.
They're doing a good job right now, just getting enough of their arms on him to get stumbling. But as they keep pounding later in the game, it'll be harder and harder to have those arm tackles affect Peters. But so far, they've been able to limit up to 4 or 5 yards of carry.
First and 10 from the 32. Faye keeps it this time, then pitches at the last moment to Burke. He's met at the 30 and brought down.
It's Johnson out there. Jason Johnson.
Jason Johnson on the tackle.
See, there he comes from his linebacker position, just pursuing down the line of scrimmage. Does a nice job getting to the running back. Nice job. It's tougher with option defense. You have to have a guy assigned to each person. They did a nice job getting a guy on Faye and then pursuit of the pitch. Good play by Johnson, Geneseo defense.
You get a look at Dan Burke. I mentioned he played a lot of positions. Quarterback, fullback, wingback, quarterback, receiver, and free safety is all this year. The give is to Peters. He's on his feet for another 4 or 5. Set a Metamora single season record with 2,082 yards as a junior.
I think Metamora right here is in 4-down territory, so they can figure they got 2 plays to get these 4 yards. See the unbalanced to the right there, unbalanced line to the right.
Bay will go that way, get the first down and more, still on his feet, inside the 10-yard line, all the way to the 4-yard line. Michael Faye, a pickup of 23 yards, and there's the big physical running style of 6'2", 190-pound senior Michael Faye.
Yeah, he does a great job cutting back, made a good fake, to Peters, keeps the ball and just runs really hard. Get the ball inside the five. He's a real big threat running the football.
Boy, we talked about that high ankle sprain. He struggled with it all year long, but last couple of weeks, he has looked really good. Kind of back to his old self again. He's just a junior. First and goal from the four. Fay keeps it himself. Up and into the end zone, is he? Yes. Into the end zone, touchdown, Michael Fay. Colin Akers kind of gave him a boost there. I think it was Colin Akers that he went over.
You'll see him just again, the same play he just ran. And here's Colin Akers, comes up, he jumps, just kind of lifts him, and the power of Fay pulls Akers into the end zone, and he gets a poster touchdown right there.
His eighth rushing touchdown of the season. Brennan Van Meegem in, he's a junior. He needs just four PATs to tie the state record for a career. And he's only a junior. Now he's three away. Metamora 7-0 lead, 9:06 to play, second quarter. Back after this local timeout. Before or after the game, the Hawthorne Sweet. Oh, there's a true believer right there. How about that?
Yeah, it'll be about 12 more years. He'll be
future
out here.
Future Maple Leaf, yeah.
Gotta love that.
They love their green machine in Geneseo. If there's anybody left in Geneseo at Lehman's Bar and Grill or Barney's Corner Bar and Grill, I bet they're watching tonight. I bet they're watching. They got some of that great Geneseo memorabilia from back in the 70s. There's Van Meegem. Boy, he usually does this. He usually gets the touchback, Greg. And that's a pretty potent weapon.
That
is
a weapon.
I saw him against St. Thomas More down here in Champaign week two of the playoffs, and they didn't get to run a kickback all day.
That's right. If you can keep them starting on the 20-yard line every time, that's a great, great weapon. Here's a look at the drive. 12 plays, 80 yards, 5:30. This is what they want to do. Just a typical Metamora drive.
I was going to say.
Culminated with a four-yard touchdown run. Not many runs. Although Michael Fay had a couple big ones in there. But that's what they do.
That's Metamora football
right
there. They did that at the end of the Rochester game. Ate up about 7-8 minutes. Atwell to give to Johnson. The first man through. And he's met just a yard past the line of scrimmage. Here's a look at our officials in Class 4A. Thomas Novotny, Patrick Geary, Jeffrey Wesley, Thomas Hugg, our referee, and Stephen Bessie. Our congratulations to those gentlemen for being here tonight, calling this game. Couldn't play it without those guys.
That's right. Give me a hug.
You have been hanging around me too long.
That's
for
right.
The Corny Lions,
that's
brother.
Right.
2nd and 8 for the Maple Leafs from their own 22. Akers has it. He's going around left end. He's got room to go. He's across the 40, the 50, and brought down at the 42-yard line. There is a flag on the play. Metamora had one come back on the kickoff return. Illegal shift.
Wow. That's definitely a momentum changer right there from first down on the 42 to now they'll be third down on their own 18 or 17 yard line.
That's illegal shift on the offense. 5-yard penalty.
That's where those penalties, it says one penalty 5 yards, but how many yards is that really?
Yeah, that's right.
You know, 40?
That's
I mean, that's.
Yeah. Legal
35.
Shift. Legal shift leads to the shift in momentum.
Ah.
I better stop with the corny.
You have become a wordsmith, my friend. 2nd and 13. Akers again around the left side. Not much that time.
Akers on the carry.
Burke there for the stop.
That's a good play though. 2nd and long, they got about 7 or 8 to get to about 3rd and 6. That's a nice play when you're backed up. Nothing too risky. Geneseo doesn't really throw the ball super well, so they got a nice gain out of that. to bring up something that's more manageable now on third down.
And they're going to get some of these, but that's still, that's the kind of yardage Metamora would like to see. Third down, 36. Akers and Johnson behind Atwell. They give us the length of coming around from the left side. And a big tackle there for Metamora's number 42. That is Sean McKee, the senior. Reading it nicely and no gain, bringing up fourth down for Geneseo.
Here's a look at it. They just run the counter. This is kind of their long yardage play is the counter, and McKee's waiting for it. He's made some a couple good plays early in this game.
Tyler Fisher to punt from his own 12-yard line. And it's that man again for Metamora, Dan Burke. Catches it as his own 42, and that's what he's met by a host of tacklers. But, you know, that's not a bad play, Greg. We've talked about this while we were off camera.
Catch the punts. We've seen it all day today. 20 to 25 yards, you let the ball bounce here on this turf down here at the University of Illinois. It is going to bounce, and it's going to cost you field position. And we talked about that, and one of the keys, when we started the game, one of the keys in the game was we said they needed to play the field, and that's what they did. They're playing field position by catching the punts.
We saw that happen in our 2A game. Rather than catching it at the 50-yard line, the ball rolled all the way down to the 20, 25-yard line. Can't afford to give up that kind of field position in a state championship game. Redbirds a 7-0 lead. Fay keeps it, running behind one of his big linemen, and he's brought down at the 45-yard line. Pickup of about three. Make it four.
This doesn't come up in the stats, but Luke Lemke just made a huge play. He's out here all alone. Big 73 coming out. He fights off the block. The way Faye's been running, if Lemke doesn't make that play, he goes for 6 points. Lemke was on an island by himself. Great football play there by Lemke.
Nick Willman is leading the way for the Redbirds. 6 minutes now to go, second quarter. Fast moving first half, much as we expected. Second and six for the Redbirds. Faye fakes the give. Throws to the right side. Has a man. That is for Boney. And he's down near the 40-yard line. First down yardage, a pickup of 13. Vince Fraboni, 6'3 sophomore with the catch.
Nice simple play action. Send the tight end out in the flat. Really tough to defend when you're playing run, 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 and then a nice little play action. Simple pass. Fay executes. Nice game.
Fay 2 for 3. Passing. Side, Burke in motion. Give it to Peters. He just twists, turns, and falls, and picks up four.
That's his style so far in this game. He's been hit. You know, they're doing a pretty good job, Geneseo, is getting a hit on him at the line of scrimmage, but he has a lot of good leg drive, and he twists and turns, ends up getting three or four after that first initial hit.
We talked about taking care of the ball. Metamora did not turn the ball over last week against Rochester. Pat Ryan says a key against Geneseo, you can't turn the ball over. All four playoff games, they were behind. A turnaround changed the game, and the Maple Leafs have ridden that all the way to the state championship game here tonight. Peters, more than three or four this time. He's all the way down to the 25-yard line. Pickup of 13 for Aaron Peters. He had 91 yards against Rochester, and we mentioned that was the only game he played in all year that he didn't total over 100 yards.
Yeah, that was the first time we've seen him get a little real estate, and he's quick. He didn't look, he looks big and powerful on the inside runs, but there he got a little space, and he's got some speed. Nice run by Aaron Peters.
Ball at the 25, first and 10. Fay under center this time. Give to Peters. Gets maybe three that time. Redbirds lost their only game of the year, the second week, to Mid-Illini arch rival Washington. A lot of people in the community, in the area, said, well, Metamora's not, they kind of said it before the season, Metamora's not as good a team as they were. They lost to Washington, kind of gave them up.
But boy, this team just kept believing in themselves, and here they are tonight. They played some really tough games over the course of the last month. We'll talk about that further in a moment. Second and seven, it's Faye again, down to the 15-yard line.
Yeah, the thing about it with Metamora is they always compare to the previous year. They're good so often that when a team maybe doesn't have as many talented players, they think, well, maybe we're not as good. But they're at a level that's above a lot of people. So even their best teams are as good as anybody around. And you're seeing it here.
Yeah, I love that. They'll go ahead and measure here that that phrase from the advertising world, kid tested, mother approved. Mm-hmm. These teams are both kid tested and approved. Pontiac, a tough week 9 game for Metamora, final of the game of the regular season. They won a hard fought 43-42 game over Pontiac. Okay, a couple of games that were kind of blowouts to start the playoffs, but then a 28-21 win at Breeze Modern Day, and that 1-point win over Rochester. You know, you kind of get thrown into the fire there, and you come out hard as steel, right?
That's right, yeah. It prepared them for a good football game like we're seeing here.
And same for Geneseo, a 2-point win over McNamara in week 2, and that 4-point win at home over Richmond Burton last weekend. Their defense really stepped up. They are a second-half team, so that's something to keep an eye out for.
And they're kind of doing it even here. They don't give up the big plays. They kind of make you drive a long way and wait for your mistake. Right now, Metamora hasn't made that mistake, but Geneseo is not making them drive. They're making them drive the ball a long way.
Third and inches. Faye keeps it. He's got the first down and brought down at the 11-yard line. Pickup of 5.
Good decision there by Coach Ryan. Typical, they're probably watching film, and they see that a lot of times Geneseo likes to bring those inside backers up the middle, and they went outside with Faye, pick up the first down.
3:15 to go, second quarter. Redbirds a 7-0 lead, looking to add to it here, deep in Geneseo territory. The give is to Peters. Tough going that time. Maybe a yard or two. This Geneseo defense only allowing 140 yards rushing per game. And the Redbirds are over 100 yards here in the first half.
Yeah, they're already giving up 145 in the first half, but it's only a 7-0 game. Now they got them in second at long. Just like they've done in the games leading up to the state championship, they bend but don't break.
See what the Redbirds have up their sleeve here on second and 8. Faye right up the middle, still on his feet. He's got room, he's in. Touchdown, Metamora. Michael Faye, the 9-yard touchdown run for the junior quarterback, and Metamora's on top by 2 scores.
Guys just fall off Faye. They're right there. Watch this. He comes right in here. Here's a good opportunity for a tackle, and they slip off of him, and he gets in the end zone.
Big number 73, Nick Willman, another good block out
That's
front.
That's right. Yep. Those guys are blocking tough, but Faye's making guys miss, breaking tackles. They say he's a quarterback in the program, but I might put an RB in front of his name. He can run the football.
Really, really brutal to try and tackle, right?
Yes,
RB. Brennan Van Meegem on for the extra point. And it's no good. Wide right for Brennan Van Meegem. 13-0. Metamora leads Geneseo with just over 2 minutes to go in the first half. Back after this on the IHSA TV network. Metamora with the lead over Geneseo, and we are just over 2 minutes to go here in the second quarter. Greg Bradshaw, and another pretty impressive drive by the Metamora Redbirds. We'll take a look at those numbers in just a second after Brennan Van Meegem kicks off. Allstate is a sophomore. He hit the game-winning field goal as time expired against Morris 2 years ago as a freshman. And it's a touchback. I was going to say, if it's not a touchback, that's an upset.
That's right.
Here's a look at the scoring drive. 9 plays, 58 yards, 460. It's almost identical to the numbers we saw in the first drive.
It was mistake-free. They didn't put the ball down on the ground. Positive yards. They never got a negative play in the drive. That's what Metamora wants to do. And nice job by Michael Faye. A couple big runs. Really, he's doing a good job really running that offense, making good decisions and breaking tackles in good games.
Well, Geneseo has been in this position before in the postseason. They've been behind and come back. Try to get something going here in the final 2 minutes of the first half. Lemke met right at the line of scrimmage. Coming up big there for Metamora, Chase Shannon, number 53.
Good defense. This is just their one of their big plays that Geneseo likes to run is that counter, but they're waiting for it right now.
Check that, 53 Preston Butner for Metamora.
Joe Wislick was there on the play as well.
Brings up second and 10 for the Maple Leafs.
This is only their 13th play of the half, Lee. They've only had the chance at the ball. This will be their third drive with only 13 plays for the whole half.
Johnson with it. He's met by David Kinney, number 10, and then wrapped up by Brian Love, number 41.
Here's a give the Jets. Watch Kinney come shooting in here nice and low. Just feel like a submarine. He comes flying in from the right side of your screen. Nice job right there by Kenny. Kenny's had some big tackles in this first half coming up from his defensive back spot.
Pick up a four. Lemke's dad used to be the radio guy for Geneseo.
Used to be. Today, this would be a good day to bring him back.
Yeah. He'd like this press box, I'll tell you that. Third and six. Big scrum in the middle. And not much doing. Redbirds defense has been outstanding so far here, Greg.
Yeah, Geneseo had their opportunity with Lemke's long run. They couldn't put points on the board, but it's really been their only bright spot on offense in the first half. Metamora calls timeout here. They're getting a little hungry, a little greedy for more.
There's a look at Pat Ryan and the stocking cap. Here's our trivia question brought to you by the Chicago Sun-Times and yourseason.com, your ultimate source for Chicagoland high school sports. Class 4A had how many 5-4 teams qualify for the playoffs this year? 4, 5, or 6?
I know one 5-4 team that's playing the state championship. Do you know that, Lee? Which team is 5-4 in the regular season is playing the state championship now?
Cary Grove.
Nope. You don't know? One team. 5-4 in the regular season playing the state championship.
That's impressive stuff.
Yeah. Are they playing that tough league? You know.
We will see them here tomorrow. Fourth and five. Geneseo to punt. Tyler Fisher. High kick but short. And we'll get anywhere near. Well, now they're going to go back and walk it off. It's still going. Back to the 43-yard line. 17 yards on that punt for Geneseo.
Poor punt at an inopportune time for Geneseo.
How many 5-4 teams qualified in Class 4A? Six. Brought to you by yourseason.com.
It's a big defensive stamp. They need a big series right here for Geneseo. There's a big difference between 3 and 2 scores.
It's the double handoff again, and there he goes. It's Zach Garber all the way down to the 10-yard line for Metamora. Pick up of 34, check that.
Really good sleight of hand by Fay. They had no idea that that ball was coming out there to Garber, and before anybody knew it, he was 15 yards downfield. On the 10-yard line now, big play on the counter to Garber.
Bay keeps it himself inside the 10, down inside the 5 all the way, just inside the 3-yard line with 16 seconds to play. And that's a 7-yard pickup. Metamora will take timeout.
Here's a good look at the last play. Look at the extra yards after he gets hit. 4 or 5 extra yards after the first hit. He's really had a nice first half. At the 3-yard line.
We saw Metamora last weekend run a two-minute drill in about 40 seconds against Rochester, and they're on the verge of doing it here again. Earlier today, Tuscola over Lexington in a hard-fought game, 14-7. Morrison bested Moroa Forsyth, the first ever state title appearance for any Morrison team in any sport, and they take home the state championship. Stillman Valley ran away from Tolono Unity in 3A, 52-22. 4A state championship to be determined here tonight, and we've got classes 5, 6, 7, and 8 for you here tomorrow at Memorial Stadium. Montini and Joliet Catholic kick it all off at 10 a.m., followed by Cary Grove and Providence. And here's Metamora looking to go up by three touchdowns. 16 seconds to go, first half. Fay keeps it himself, looks for a blocker, has him, steps in, touchdown, Michael Fay. His third touchdown of the night, and it's 19-0 Metamora.
Just a very simple lead play here for the quarterback. He makes the cutback. Michael Fay, big play Fay, we called him earlier. He's got three touchdowns in the first half, and really big score. Nice job by Metamora, calling the timeout, getting good field position off the bad punt, taking advantage of it to get up by three scores before the half.
This offensive line was inexperienced coming in, Greg, but boy, they are doing the job here tonight. Fay back to throw, has a man, it's Burke in the end zone for the two-point conversion to give Metamora the 21-0 lead. That one was executed perfect.
Yeah, it was. Right now, whatever Coach Ryan's calling, it's working. It's nice to coach when whatever you call is successful, and that's kind of how it's going right now for the Metamora Redbirds.
Take another look at the run by Michael Fay. He gets Aaron Peters out in front of him and then steps to his right, and just a clear lane there. Nice job of cutting back, and here's the PAT.
Just very simple, little play action fake. And really just stealing right there. Dan Burke wide open, uncovered, great play action, and just a really good first half here. Actually, second quarter, it was knotted at zero after one, and big second quarter for Metamora.
21 points in the second quarter for the Redbirds. You can't see it because he's wearing the helmet, but Michael Fay, maybe not a dead ringer, but pretty close to Val Kilmer, a young Val Kilmer. Those quarterbacks with the Hollywood good looks, you know all about that, right?
Yeah, right now he looks like Vince Young, the way he's running up and down.
21-0, the Metamora lead. Geneseo set to receive. The Maple Leafs have been in this spot before. They trail Plano 16-0 in the first round as Van Meegem bounces one right up the middle, and it's fielded by Josh Ward. And Geneseo will have 8 seconds left in the second quarter. Return of 9 yards for the up man, Josh Ward. And there is a pretty timely scoring drive for the Redbirds.
Yeah, we saw them eating up clock on their first two drives. This time they didn't want to use the clock. They wanted to move quickly. They did what they needed to do, 43 yards in only 28 seconds, culminated by Fay's third touchdown of the night.
Well, takes the snap. Johnson met right at the line of scrimmage. Boy. Metamora defense playing a superb first half, Greg Bradshaw, shutting out the Maple Leafs. And offense 221 yards for Metamora total. 199 on the ground, 22 in the air, and they have just done a little bit of everything here.
Yeah, they have. Really, there was only one play, 105 yards of total offense for Geneseo. I don't know how many were on the one lefty run, 70. So other than that, about 35 yards of total offense in total for Geneseo during that first half. Pretty much dominated by Metamora, and going locker room 21-0.
Scott Leber is with Pat Ryan.
That's right. Coach, you got to love what you've seen so far in this first half.
Well, I tell you what, sometimes it comes down to little things. If we don't trip their guy at the end, if Burke doesn't catch him, it's 7-0. And this thing, it's always, this game is such a strange game. And then we got a break on the miss. I doubt that kids missed too many, so. But I do know this. These guys have not been ahead at halftime every game, but they've won every tournament game they've been into. So we got some work to do. There's no question.
I understand Michael Fay at times has been a little dinged up this year, but boy, he's looking healthy and good tonight.
Well, one time it seemed like 2/3 of our guys were dinged up. But yes, Michael's kind of come into his own. But hey, we got to play a great second half to win this game, and hopefully we've still got two great quarters in us.
All right, Coach, thank you. Good luck in the second half. Back to Lee and Greg.
All right, Scott Lever, I've covered Pat Ryan football teams for 20 years, and you know, coaches are never happy, are they?
He's not happy. I'll tell you what, though, he looks like he could put a helmet and shoulder. He's hungry. I love his enthusiasm. You could tell he'd be a great guy to play.
You know, they're still fired up in that Geneseo locker room, too. Back after this local timeout.
Metamora in their 10th state championship game, Geneseo in their 9th, and it's the Redbirds. Have the big lead at the half, looking for championship win number 3. Welcome back to our studios here on the IHSA TV network. I'm Dave Bernhardt, joined by Sherrard head coach Jason Kirby and Wilmington head coach Jeff Reintz. And we just heard Pat Ryan come off the field, and you look up at the scoreboard and you want to say, Coach, you're up 21-0. But that's the nature of the coaching business. And both of you two have been here. You have done that. What's it like at halftime when you feel, okay, we're up 21, but there's two quarters to go?
Well, I think, you know, you always think about the worst things that happened during the game. And you saw Coach Ryan there at halftime. He wasn't talking necessarily about the good things that Metamora did, but the things that almost got to him.
Right.
And I think that speaks true to every head coach and what he thinks coming off in such a big game.
They're not back.
Now we're back.
Seven, so what are we doing?
5, 4, same time. 3, 2, 1.
Metamora in their 10th state championship game. They have won twice. Geneseo looking for their 5th win in their 9th appearance. And right now it's the Redbirds, that 3-touchdown lead here at the half of our 4A state championship game. And thanks for joining us once again here on the IHSA TV network. I'm Dave Bernhardt, joined by Sherrard head coach Jason Kirby and Wilmington head coach Jeff Reintz. And we just got done hearing Pat Ryan talk about all the things that he was all fired up about and not too happy about. And you want to say, Coach, turn around, look at the board. You're up 21-0, but it doesn't always work that way.
No, it doesn't. You know, as a head coach, you know, you're not thinking about the things that you did well during the first half. You're thinking about the things that almost got you. And, you know, Geneseo had a couple big plays that got called back, and Geneseo missed a field goal. But as a head coach in such a big game, you kind of forget about the positives, and you think about the negatives and how to correct them.
You might, but, I mean, it's 70 yards total offense.
Right.
And being positive and getting after your kids is one thing, but I'm pretty sure walking in the locker room, I might have cracked a little bit of a smile, thinking, hey, I think we got a shot at this thing. But I think he is right. Geneseo will go in. They'll make great adjustments, just as they did last week to come back on Richmond Burton in the second half. They made adjustments to give themselves an opportunity to win, and then their kids did the things that they needed to do to be successful. I'm thinking that Geneseo's probably going in at halftime doing that exact same thing this week and saying, we've come back before, let's do it again.
All right, and speaking of coming back, we will come back. We'll have stats and highlights and a lot more here at the half of your 4A state championship ball game. Metamora 21, Geneseo nothing. Back after these words from your local sponsors.
3, 2, 1.
Bands performing here at the half, our final game of the day, the 4th game here in our state finals. 5 more games, 4.5 games, we should say, still coming your way. Dave Bernhardt, Jason Kirby, and Jeff Reintz alongside with you. And before we take a look at our stats, early on in this game, Geneseo busts off a long run, a 70-yard run by Luke Lemke, but they cannot finish. That was a major key early in this game.
Yeah, I would say that was the major key, but even before that point, for them to have enough confidence to stop Metamora on their opening drive, I think that gave their team and their kids a great deal of lift and confidence that, hey, we can play with these guys, let's go. They get that taken care of, they get the long run, they're feeling pretty confident.
Yeah, I think so, and I think that's something they're gonna hit on at halftime. You know, we did have some success at during times during the first half, and let's come back and try to establish that in the second half.
Well, the one problem with that, though, was that was the only time they stopped Metamora. Redbirds scoring on their other 3 possessions. Let's take a look at those first half stats brought to you by Menards. Save big money at Menards. We mentioned a 70-yard run by Luke Lemke. That is the 70 of those 105 yards on the ground. On the other side, Metamora, 12 first downs, 12-2 first down advantage, nearly 200 yards rushing.
That rushing total is pretty sound. They're 28 carries for 199 compared to 15 for 105. That's a pretty telling stat of really how the first half went.
You take a look at some of the other numbers that sometimes don't always reveal themselves, but penalties. A couple of penalties really hurt the Maple Leafs in the first half.
Boy, it really did. And, you know, they had a couple big runs, and the penalties came and bit them in the foot a little bit. And that's something you have to deal with as a team and try to come back from that. I think the kicker for Metamora, Brennan Vandegum, I think for him to put the ball into the end zone, I think that's a weapon that people don't understand. For a team to have to drive the ball from the 20-yard line, that is a huge weapon and a defensive coordinator's best friend, to tell you the truth. To have that kind of field position, and Metamora's established that the whole first half.
And in addition to that, it seemed like the Maple Leafs have always been in third and long. And for them, third and long is third and five and third and six, and that is so very tough with the type of offense that they would run.
No doubt. Much as we saw in the 3A game with Stillman, they need to be in third and manageable, which is three, at most four. Getting the five and six number, that's a lot tougher for them to accomplish, especially when you're talking about playing in a title game against Metamora.
Time for highlights, and if they're wearing red, they're going to be in our highlight package. Metamora Redbirds. This is Michael Fay, the quarterback, and this will not be a series of replays. This is Faye all the way down to the 4-yard line. Michael Faye, the quarterback for Metamora in the second quarter, and from 4 yards out, number 15, Michael Faye, 6'2", 190-pounder, will take it in for the first of his three scores. This capped off a 12-play, 80-yard drive and put the Redbirds on top 7-0. Then with 2:16 to play in the first half, Faye again, this time 9 yards out as he hits that corner of the end zone. The extra point was no good, left the score 13-0. But then again, new play, 12 seconds left in the half. Faye from 3 yards out. That cuts the margin, or makes it up to 19-0, and now looking to get those 2 points back. There it is to Burke, the pass from Faye, and that is the score we sit at the half, the 3-touchdown lead for the Metamora Redbirds. And we'll have more at the half from Memorial Stadium right after this in your 4A title game. Oh, you just missed it. Both down on the field with the Geneseo band and with Lee Hall up here in the press box as we are rocking here at the half as Metamora has that 3-touchdown lead, 21-0 in our 4A championship ball game. Dave Bernhardt, Jason Kirby, and Jeff Reince back with you. And this has become one of my favorite parts of our halftime segment. When we look back at the keys to the game that you saw prior to the game, when we played two quarters, now we look back. First of all, for Geneseo, how are they doing, Jason?
Well, eat the clock and score. They've ate the clock a little bit, but they haven't scored. They haven't put the one on that they had the opportunity to. Have a lot of trouble in third and long, as we said. Backers blitzing, they have been. Metamora's done a nice job of picking that up. And certainly their fumble frenzy that they've been so successful on so far in the playoffs, they haven't got the turnovers that they've really needed to get from Metamora.
So for Metamora, the 21-0 lead, these were their keys to the game. Jeff Reince tells us how it's going.
Well, I tell you what, right off the bat, big play Faye. They hit it right off the bat. I think the experience that he has from last year and all of this year is really paying off for Metamora right now. They are jamming up Johnson. There's no doubt about that. Only allowing Geneseo two first downs during the first half. What a great job by Metamora's defense. And they are playing the field very well. They're playing the whole field. One thing I'm very impressed with Metamora right now is there are a lot of counter plays by Geneseo, and Metamora is staying home. And so they're playing very disciplined football right now, which is an attribute to Coach Ryan and his staff.
One of the good news, bad news things that are emerging out of this one, Michael Fay has had such a huge first half. Aaron Peters hasn't exploded for Metamora the way he's capable of doing.
Well, I think you can see with Geneseo, their attack defensively has been to shut him down. The result being, Fay is going to take care of business then.
How do you, if you're Geneseo defensively, Jeff, how do you stop a team that just continually gets the 3, the 4, the 5, then maybe busts a 7 or 8 or 10 yarder? How do you defend that here in the second half?
Well, I'm sure Geneseo, you know, they've broken it down during the week, and they have to make a decision. Is it a scheme issue, or is it just something that our players have to do a better job of? They'll talk about that, I'm sure, at halftime and try to make those adjustments. They're probably going to have to take some chances with some blitzes and things along those lines the second half, but I'm sure Coach Johnson will make those adjustments.
For Metamora, Jason, two teams that like to run. Now, they're different type of running offenses, but with the defense that the Redbirds have been running out there against Geneseo, How much of a factor is it that you practice against an offense similar to that every single day?
Well, I don't think that there's ever the opportunity to practice against the exact same thing simply because you're playing against a state champion quality team. So that's going to be difficult to get the timing down. But it's really important that your scout team guys give you the correct look through the course of the week and understand the aspects of what Metamora is trying to do. I think that Coach Johnson, I'm sure, had that taken care of during the course of the week. But like I said, once you get out there, you're still going to deal with all-state players that you didn't deal with in practice and a level of speed that you haven't seen as well.
We've sat here through four games here this afternoon, and it seems like every time we've sat here just before we get ready to take our next break, we always say who has the ball first in the third quarter. It's always been the team that's been trailing, and tonight, once again, it's Geneseo. They need to make something happen on this first drive.
I believe, and we've talked about it all day, like you said, if they can come out and get themselves some confidence. We've talked about momentum all day long with these playoff games, and that's going to be a big part of this. Can your kids get momentum and get that confidence to make sure they can stop Metamora, and can they move the ball on Metamora?
Well, that's what we will find out in our next couple of quarters, halfway home here in a 4A state championship game. Metamora 21-0 over Geneseo, and we will have more from Memorial Stadium. Second half coming up after this.
Geneseo head coach Larry Johnson Jr. joining us right now. Larry, what do you guys have to do here to get this thing turned in your favor?
Well, we have to do a better job with the fundamentals and the blocking and tackling and running with the ball. And play with some more confidence. We're down here a little bit, 21-0, and we just got to come back and play and credit Metamora. They've taken advantage of some situations that we've given them.
How big is this opening possession for your team here to start this second half?
Well, it's really big. We've got to get something established. The way to make plays defensively is to keep their offense off the field, obviously. And so we're not getting first downs offensively. We're not doing a good enough job on first down.
All right. Thank you, Coach. Good luck. Okay, Jim and Greg, back to you.
All right, Scott, Lee Hall, Greg Bradshaw up here up top. And, he just talked about, Larry Johnson Jr. just talked about first down. We're not doing a good enough job on first down. And when we talked about what Pat Ryan had said, we want to get him into second and third long. And that's part of what the defense has done here tonight for the Redbirds.
Yeah, they have. And that's going to be a challenge. It's going to be a challenge for Geneseo because right now on the line of scrimmage, Metamora has been controlling it on both offensive side and defensive side. They're going to have to get plays more physical this half. They need to establish something early. And everyone's talking about this first drive is really important.
Well, there we see both bands kind of commingling. We saw them at halftime. The battle of the bands, the battle of the teams has gone to Metamora so far. But we talk about the great tradition, Greg. Title towns, both of them down here. Metamora and Geneseo combined 60 playoff appearances. Geneseo's only missed 2 years in the entire history of the playoffs. 19 state final berths between the two teams, 6 state titles.
Yeah, that's great. It's great tradition, great football, and right now, we'd say that Metamora's got the better of it.
Well, and it's kind of funny. Geneseo wears the Green Bay Packer-like uniforms and kind of like the Packers. They would have been in the finals the first 3 years, the Packers' 2 Super Bowls. These guys would have been in the playoffs the first 3 years had not they been upset by Geneva. And then Metamora played Geneva, won the state championship. That was way back in 1975 under John Helmick. And then the next 2 years, Metamora and Geneseo met. Geneseo won 20-12 in 1976. Pat Ryan was in 7th grade. He said, we had one going in and we fumbled, and that cost Morton the game. Then in 77, Geneseo won 34-0, or as Pat Ryan put it, they pee-patched us. I said, Coach, I got to stop you. What does pee-patched us mean? Pee-patched? I've never heard that, let alone as a verb. Well, they took us out to the pee patch.
That's right.
Kind of like to the woodshed, I guess.
I was at that game, and man, it was a shellacking. Physical football, Geneseo style. And that's what they're going to have to do this second half.
Ironically, I said to Coach Johnson, I said, well, I've been to Geneseo. I saw a football game there in 1983 when you guys played Spalding. And he said, that's my alma mater. He said, no, that was 82, and I was the ball boy. And I can tell you,
he knows them all.
Spalding had a really good team that year, and boy, Geneseo beat them, I think it was 20-3 or 26-3. Geneseo's running backs were bigger than Spalding's line. I mean, it was an impressive display, and they went on to win the state championship that year. It was 1982, and they beat Springfield Griffin in 1982 for the state championship. Larry Johnson Jr., a 1986 graduate of Geneseo High School. They lost to Washington his senior year. Washington went on to win. They come from the same conference, the Middle Illini, as Metamora.
Well, we've seen Brennan Van Meegan put two into the end zone earlier today. Let's see if he does it here again.
He's getting some major college notice. Illinois, Iowa.
A little shorter this time.
Short this time, and Geneseo will get a chance to bring it back. An unusual return. Lemke brings it across the 20 where he's brought down. A pickup of 15 for Luke Lemke. Yeah, Van Meegan, and Coach talked about it there at halftime, Greg. He's a great, great weapon for this Metamora team. And this time it didn't get all the way to the end zone, so the Geneseo will start on the 22.
That's
so there
right.
wasn't much difference there.
They got two extra yards out of it.
An all-important third-quarter opening drive for the Maple Leafs, who trail it here 21-0, 105 yards offense. 70 of that came on one play. Give is to Johnson. He's out to about the 25 before he's stopped. A gain of three. Johnson, 2,113 career rushing yards coming into tonight. Three-year starter for the Maple Leafs.
New look from Geneseo. They had two guys in the backfield, not starting with a double wing. Just for the little lead play there for Johnson. Get some positive yards.
Brings up second and seven for Geneseo. The Green Machine, as they're affectionately known at home, 11-2 coming in. Akers in motion. He has it. Jumps across the 25-yard line, and he goes out at about the 26.
Just a quick jet sweep there to Akers. Gets a couple of yards. It's still third and long here for the Maple Leafs.
This Metamora defense, no senior linebacker. First time in Pat Ryan's 20 years. He says it took a while to develop leadership and consistency. That second game of the season against Washington, he said Washington hurt us where we were young. Those linebackers have come a long way for the Redbirds this season. That's amazing. First time in 20 years, no senior linebackers. And a pass attempt for the Maple Leafs. Akers is the open man. He has it near midfield, and he is brought down across midfield after a pickup of 27 yards. David Kenny with the stop.
Just a nice throw right here by Atwell. Just nice play action pass. That's a big weapon for them, and they can do it. Just such an element of surprise from Geneseo when they do throw, even when it's third and long, and good execution there by Atwell. And a great catch.
Atwell exactly 50% on the season, 52 for 104. Just 418 yards passing. This time is the pitch to Lemke. He's got room to run. Steps inside the 30, and then he's brought down at the 25. A pickup of 22 yards. Jesse Mishler finally grabs him, and boy, Geneseo has new life. We said they're a second-half team.
That's right.
And they're showing new life here to start the second half.
Just great blocking downfield. There's Atwell throwing a nice block for Lemke. Just a nice little sweep, little toss sweep. Good blocking out front. Little life in the stadium now from the Geneseo side.
First and 10 from the 25. The first sustained drive, and now a fumble. Atwell stumbled, looked like he might have gotten tripped by a lineman. The ball hit the turf. And the indication is that the Maple Leafs have it.
Wow, watch this right here. He trips and he throws, almost throws the ball to Johnson. Johnson's very fortunate
very
he got
lucky.
Back on it.
I was just about to say the first sustained drive of the evening for Geneseo, and a tough break there. Atwell gets tripped up by his own man and that almost caused the turnover.
That's right. Does back them up now, second and long.
Second and 12 now. They lose a couple. They retain possession.
Lemke in motion. Back to throw is Atwell, looking downfield, incomplete. Burke on the coverage. Akers was the intended receiver. And it'll bring up third and 12 for the Maple Leafs.
We tried a little bootleg here on second down. Johnson got caught up. He couldn't get out. The fullback couldn't get to the flat, so he really had one option. He tried to throw it in a very small little window. Good defense there by Burke. Two down territory here for Geneseo. Or four down, we should say. We got two more downs to get it.
Third and 12, Geneseo trying to get on the board. Atwell to throw again. He's looking for a man, has Lemke. It's complete. He's out at the 6-yard line, a pickup of 21. Boy, Geneseo really out of character here, but making it work in the opening moments of the third quarter.
Great job by, there's not a lot of room here. And Atwell just throws it right over the shoulder, right to Lemke. Good coverage right there. But really, Kenny was right on it, but it was just a perfect throw, perfect catch. First and goal inside the six.
Michael Atwell has known since he was a kindergartner that he wanted to be the quarterback at Geneseo. His kindergarten teacher's son was a quarterback. She brought him into school one day. So he's known for a long time that he wanted to be in these shoes. Lemke around the right side. He's going to go in. He takes it in. Geneseo is on the board. And you can hear the Maple Leaf fans after a 6-yard touchdown run by Luke Lemke.
Lemke just sees the opening to the corner, just uses his speed, and walks into the corner of the end zone. I'll tell you what, they believe, Lee. They believe.
His 22nd touchdown of the year. And now Lemke for the point after attempt that would make it a 2-touchdown ball game. Metamora has been susceptible to the pass in the postseason. And Geneseo takes advantage of that. We've got extra point good. We've got a flag on the play. I believe it'll be a roughing the kicker.
There is a penalty flag on the play.
We'll go against Metamora, and that will be assessed on the kickoff.
Looks like
is that correct?
Yes, definitely.
I didn't see who hit him, but somebody in trying to block the kick ran into Luke Lemke.
Oh. Roughing the kicker. Defense. 15 yards will be assessed on the kickoff.
So it's 21-7 here in the third. We're back after this local timeout. Here's a look at the penalty before we went to break on the roughing the kicker call. Right up the gut was Dane Kemp, and he got a lot of Luke Lemke. Almost got the ball, but he got a lot of the kicker in. Geneseo will kick from the Metamora 45-yard line after that penalty. So it looks like it'll be Metamora with the long field this time. Brennan Van Meegem has kicked a couple into the end zone this time. And Lemke's going to try and make him run it back. Burke with it at his own 8. Scoots out to the 18. Good coverage that time by Geneseo. Aaron Kotecki, the linebacker, with the tackle that time. And there's a look. Well, that drive looks eerily similar to the first two by Metamora.
Yeah, except that they didn't use a ton of clock because of the big pass plays, which is surprising but effective. And that was a really big, big drive. We talked about it at halftime. They had to get some points on the board, and they did just that.
Yeah, that's interesting. Breeze Mater Day. Rochester all able to score points through the air against the Redbirds, and it was the passing game that set up that touchdown for Geneseo to get them on the board. Bay in the shotgun, fakes the handoff, keeps it himself, and he's out to the 25-yard line. Pickup of 7. Blake Kroger with the stop for Geneseo.
Same thing we saw in the first half, a little fake to Peters, following then the big lineman, back to the left, fake, gets a nice gain of 7 yards. This is the place where Geneseo is going to have to do it on defense. They're going to get back in this ball game. They're going to have to stop Metamora.
Second and 3 for the Redbirds. working Peters on either side of Fay. Peters with it this time. He's out across the 30 to about the 34-yard line. It'll be another Metamora first down pickup of 9 for Peters. He now has 65 yards rushing, 103 yards on the ground for the quarterback, Michael Fay.
Yeah, they've been a good 1-2 punch early in the game, particularly Fay. This has kind of been Geneseo's recipe in the second half has been get on the board and then take advantage of turnovers. And Metamora has not played along yet by putting that ball on the ground.
They put it on the ground once, but they did recover. Peters has a nice lane there. Akers with the tackle as he gets across the 40-yard line. Pickup of 7. What, 7 or 8 yards of Aaron Peters at a time, and that's going to be in the end zone before too long.
That's right. Well, it's been a good start offensively. Metamora needed to have a good drive here and just establish control again of the football game, and they've got an early success here on the stretch.
Second and 3. Hey, keeps it. He's across midfield and down at the 48-yard line. Andrew Walters with the stop, pickup of 11. And Michael Fay just keeps on trucking. We talk about his injuries. He missed 2 games with an ankle injury earlier in the year. Came back. What did he do? He ran for 119 yards against East Peoria. So he is a tough guy. He's played hurt all year long, basically, when he has played. Metamora now in Geneseo territory with 7:19 and counting in the third quarter. Redbirds lead 21-7. Peters, left side. He could go all the way. 48 yards for Aaron Peters, and the Redbirds answer.
Simple play right up the middle. Linebackers been playing wide. Peters right up the middle. Great block by number 81.
Austin Ford.
Austin Ford, big block on Kotecki. Knocking Kotecki down. Nobody in his way. Peters, big touchdown.
His first touchdown of the ball game. Number 29 on the season for Aaron Peters. Now Brennan Van Meegem out for the extra point try. Made one, missed one. That one's up and good. So he's now 2 away from tying the state record. Metamora answers the Geneseo drive to open the second half. And it's 28-7. Metamora the lead. Back after this on the IHSA TV network. Well, Geneseo did what they had to do. They came out and scored on their opening drive of the second half. But then the Redbirds answer in big time fashion.
Of the Red Sea. And he goes right down the gut.
Untouched for Aaron Peters.
On dry land.
Metamora has scored on their last 4 possessions.
Yeah, they punted the first time. They had the football, and since then, they've scored each time. Good view right there.
And Megan, the kickoff. Just at the goal line. And brought out by Billy Hamer. Out to the 25-yard line. 26-yard line.
Nice return.
There's the Metamora drive. Well, that we talked about Geneseo's drive didn't eat up a lot of clock. That one didn't either.
Yeah, well, it's a big run by Peters. It's a really nice open hole. And Peters takes it to the house.
Metamora on offense in the postseason, 423 yards against Rochester total offense, 338 against Modern Day. And that's Jason Johnson out near the 30-yard line. 396 total yards against St. Thomas More. They put up 452 total yards against Central Catholic in week 1, and they're over 300 here tonight with a quarter and a half to play.
Yeah, they know how to chew up the yards.
got some weapons in both Peters and Faye, certainly.
Geneseo needs to answer yet again. It's Atwell to throw. He's got a man, and it's complete. That's Hunter Fears with the catch.
Another nice throw by Atwell. Just fakes out there to Johnson. Comes back. Good delivery. Right on the numbers. First down.
And Atwell's not one of those guys that's about stats first. Larry Johnson Jr. said before the season at a practice they had been trying to work on some things like this where they're throwing the ball. Atwell asked him why they hadn't put the inside belly offense in yet. He wanted to make sure that this team was doing what it does best. As Lemke tries to cut back, and he's met by a host of Redbirds for no gain. You got to give Atwell credit, though. He has done a nice job throwing the football tonight for a guy that doesn't throw it very much. 3 for 4, 57 yards.
That's right. He's throwing the ball right on the money each time, and looks real comfortable back there. He's getting good time because of the play-action fake.
A 4.25 grade point average, schools he's looking at. Notre Dame, Northwestern, Washington University down in St. Louis for academics.
I like one of those schools, and yeah. I don't like one of the others.
Okay, Mr. Wildcat. Here's Akers with men in front. Oh, but there's David Kenny again for the tackle. Burke was right there with him. And we talked about Kenny, and maybe weren't so sure he would see a lot of time tonight as far as in the making of plays. But boy, he comes up from that defensive back and makes some tackles where you would maybe expect a linebacker to on other defense.
Well, against Geneseo, your defensive backs are more like linebackers. He's been getting his nose up on the line of scrimmage, making some really nice tackles. Very aggressive defensive back play by Kevin.
Third down and 7 here for the Maple Leafs at their own 41. Akers in motion. Atwell to throw again. Looking downfield. Under pressure. Incomplete. Joe Wislick, number 44, the 6'2", 195-pound senior, was right in his line of sight, and Atwell threw it short.
Not much chance for Atwell there. His receivers got jammed up on a line of scrimmage. Good job by the outside linebackers from Metamora holding up the both receivers. They couldn't get out free.
Fisher to punt. Burke and Kenny back for Metamora. Burke calling for a fair catch, and he almost bobbled it, but he brings it in at the 35-yard line, a punt of just 24 yards. And the Redbirds will take over with a 21-point lead with 4:27 to go here in the third quarter. 4A state championship. Metamora, this is the first time they've been in 4A since they went to the 8-class system. Here's a look at tomorrow's games. Montini and Joliet Catholic in 5A gets things started tomorrow morning, bright and early. Cary Grove against Providence in 6A. And that is followed by Glenbard West, Wheaton-Warrenville South in 7A. And the nightcap, Maine South and Marist about 7 o'clock here in Champaign. Fay in the shotgun. They give his to Burke. And he's got about 5 or 6 yards there. Burke had 207 yards and a touchdown in a win over Morton when he played fullback. He played quarterback against Pekin. I mean, he's done just a little bit of everything. I said, how do you keep it all straight? And he, you know, kind of laughed at me and said, well, I was a quarterback when I was a sophomore. You know, it's not that hard. I mean, he likes running the football.
In Metamora, they know the offense when they're like in fifth grade.
That's right. That's not an exaggeration, by the way. Fay with it on his feet across midfield. Boy, he is a tough runner. He's not a huge guy, but boy, he's just tough to bring down. He's long.
He runs hard. Here's a good look at him right here. He just runs hard. Watch him just after the first hit. There, he just falls forward about 4 extra yards after first contact. He's got his shoulders going downhill. He's not a juker. He's a slasher. He's strong.
13-yard pickup for Michael Fay and the Redbirds. First and 10 at the 48-yard line. Metamora won here 2 years ago. They lost here last season in the state championship game in 5A to Wheaton St. Francis.
Third straight trip to the championship for Metamora. Fay will not be arm tackled. He's forced out of bounds at the 39-yard line. We saw a missed tackle there. He just, you really got to get a body on it, don't you?
Yeah, he's strong. Here you see him again coming out here. You'll see him, first tackler, tries to arm tackle. He spins out of it and then just won't go down. They ride him out of bounds about all they can do.
I tell you what, another key, Greg, for this Metamora offense was getting Tyler Birch back up front, big number 57. Pat Ryan says there's no better offensive tackle in the Middle Illini Conference. He has great technique. He was out for quite a few games. Most of the season had cartilage replacement surgery. So getting that big fella back has been a big key for this offensive line. Second and one. Peters nowhere to go. He'll get an up-close and personal look at those Geneseo jerseys. Larry Johnson was kidding earlier in the week about when his father was coach, there was an inventory reduction in jerseys, is how he put it. A lot of jerseys disappeared. He thought he might see a lot of them here tonight. His dad was maybe hoping to reclaim some of those old jerseys that maybe didn't fit so well anymore.
That's right. That's right. Well, looking down here, there's a lot of the former players in the stands, and they're hopeful for that Geneseo can get something together here in the second half.
It's just great tradition on both sides of the football. Both communities love their football teams and kind of live and die with it. Here's Faye, still on his feet. Boy, how many guys missed him that time before they brought him down? Gain of 3 yards the hard way for Michael Faye, but a couple of guys had chances and didn't get him.
You see, they just he gets out of the arm tackles, falls forward, just good strong run. He's 190 pounds. He maybe doesn't look it, but he's pretty well built. 196 to 190 pounds. He delivers a blow when he runs too.
And he is really just, I mean, as his health has gotten better, he has gotten better in the postseason. I asked Pat Ryan, what's his future? He said, I think he's a scholarship guy.
Yeah, he can throw the ball. We didn't get to see a lot of his throwing ability, but he can throw it.
Here's Burke around the right side, stepping back through the little fella. Oh my goodness, down to the 30. It's a pickup of about 6. There's another look at Burke.
Nice cutback here by Burke. Slipping a couple tackles. They're doing a good job holding on to the football because Geneseo has made some big hits, but these running backs are holding on to the ball.
One of his teammates called Burke the little engine that could. He's also like the Energizer Bunny. He just keeps going and going and going from one position to the next. Second and 4. 28-7, the Redbirds lead. They're driving again here as time runs out in the third quarter. Peters tackled there by Hunter Fears. Brought down at about the 26-yard line.
Real close.
Very close to a first down.
Looks like we're going to get a measurement.
Official timeout for a measurement.
It's just Geneseo can't string enough good plays together to really get a stop. They'll get one play for no gain. Next one goes for 8 or 9. Then they got third one. It's just, they just can't string them together.
You were talking about Metamora. We haven't seen Faye throw the ball that much. He was 7 for 7 last week, which is a lot of passing for a Metamora football team. And I asked Pat Ryan about that. He said, you know, in Metamora, every time we throw a pass, it's a revelation. And we threw a halfback pass last weekend. It just about put everybody under.
It was beautiful.
And it was a beautifully executed play. He's like, those things are pretty good when they work.
That's
if
right.
They don't, they don't look so good. But about 7 to 9 passes a game for Metamora is ideal. Faye's only thrown it 3 times tonight. Hasn't really had to.
But they execute. I mean, the special play that they ran last week, their pass plays that they run, there's just excellent execution. They're just well coached, and they do what they're told to do.
Both quarterbacks combined 5 for 8 throwing. We didn't expect to see a lot of that tonight. Faye keeps it on the ground. Gets 2 or 3, keeps the clock rolling. Under a minute to go now in the third quarter.
Nice play there by Aaron Kotecki, but that's just a big load with Faye coming at you. Kotecki made such a big play last week on 4th down, really to get them to the finals. It was 4th and 3, and he came up and just stuffed the play to really clinch the victory last week. He's a great football player.
Birkin Peters surround Fay, who keeps it himself. He's running left. He's got room. He's in. Touchdown, Metamora. Michael Fay, the 24-yard touchdown run. The fourth touchdown of the night for Metamora's junior quarterback. And the Redbirds go back up by four touchdowns.
You'll see Nick Willman out here, big number 73. Watch this block. You can't see it, but he pancaked the DB, and Michael Fay just goes into the end zone. Great job by Willman, number 73 out there. It's paving the way for his quarterback.
This will be the third extra point make for Brennan Van Meegem if it goes through. Boy, we put the jinx on him.
Yeah, he missed it.
He's still too shy of the all-time state record, but he's got all next year to take care of that, doesn't he? 2 seconds to go here in the third. It's 34-7. Metamora with the convincing lead over Geneseo with 12 minutes and 2 seconds to play.
Michael Fay, 20 carries, 166 yards, four touchdowns. Aaron Peters, 15 carries, 123 yards and a touchdown. They're executing their offense perfectly. Great job by those offensive linemen. And they've really got Geneseo's defense on their heels.
They had 180 yards in the playoffs to open against Bloomington Central Catholic, 180 yards, two touchdowns. So it's not an unusual night for Michael Fay by any stretch of the imagination. It's been Fay and Peters most of the year for Metamora. But another guy who's kind of an unsung hero on this Metamora team, Bo Geyer, backup quarterback who took over for Michael Fay and really put up some good numbers of his own while Fay was out with injury and helped get this team to where it is today.
Good players win championships, but so do systems. And they can put other people in these positions, and they still execute because they do the fundamental things very well. They block, they tackle, and you're seeing a good example of it tonight.
Billy Hamer fields at his own four-yard line for Geneseo. He gets out to the 24-yard line, and that tackle brings a roar from the Metamora sideline. Boy, great turnout here tonight. So far, it's all Metamora 34-7 leading Geneseo as they go for the 4A state championship. Michael Fay leading the way for the Redbirds back after this local timeout. Scott Leber downstairs, and it's Metamora, another nine-play drive. Michael Fay, 24-yard touchdown run, the junior quarterback, four of the five touchdowns tonight for the Redbirds, and the Maple Leafs find themselves in a big hole as they start at their own 22-yard line. Atwell looking deep, throws short instead, and one hops it to Blake Kroger. Here's a look at our Menards stats through three quarters. Save big money at Menards, and look at the first downs. Look at the score. Look at the rushing yards.
Yeah, it's been pretty lopsided here. Metamora, again, has done a great job both offensively and defensively. And it's been really their night in controlling the football. Fay and Peters dominating.
Second and 10 for the Green Machine. Akers with it. Kenny was in there on the stop for Metamora. Tom Bieneman in there as well, number 11.
Yeah, Geneseo doesn't want to really be in this situation, just down by so many points. This is not the kind of game that they can, they like to be in, obviously. They're better, obviously, from the front because of their style.
Third down and seven. Atwell in the shotgun. And it's complete and a first down for Geneseo. Blake Kroger on the reception for the Maple Leafs.
Nice throw by Atwell, just steps right into it, throws the out route right on the money. First down. Again, good look at Michael Atwell. Really, the incompletions that he's had today has been throwaways because there hasn't been anybody open.
He's 4 of 7 for 68 yards.
Takes the handoff, rolls, looks deep. Has a man, Lemke, but just overthrows him. Kenny there on the coverage, but Lemke was open on that one.
Just a little overthrown there by Atwell.
Luke Lemke, the cousin of U.S. Olympic gymnast Bridget Sloan, who won a silver medal in the Olympics and recently won the world title. And now he's playing for a state title today. Their mothers, former Cosgraves, rather, from East Moline. So
you know where the talent comes
from. Pretty impressive family ties.
It's the moms.
Yeah.
Sorry, dads.
Yeah. Send your cards and letters to Greg Bradshaw. Akers with it. Larry Johnson talks about the system, you know, the wing tee. You know, it's been around since, you know, the 50s.
Leather helmets.
Yeah, leather helmets, no face masks. But, you know, we've the new defensive schemes, you have to tweak and make a few adjustments here and there. But, you know, this is what we're comfortable with. This is Geneseo football. Akers, left side. He's got some room to run and gets out of bounds across midfield. Pickup of 11.
A little toss sweep has been a really nice play for them tonight. Here it is out here. You got big guys out front blocking. There's Johnson throwing a nice block.
Atwell, the quarterback.
Yep, Atwell's out there, and that's really been a big play for them this evening is that little sweep.
Talked about them being a second half machine coming in. They were outscored 112 to 103 in the first half. Geneseo outscoring their opponents 225 to 42 in the second half coming into tonight's game. Atwell throws it the last second. It's picked off by Burke. Dan Burke with the interception. He's got room to run. He's at the 30. Steps inside at the 30, 25, now 20. Still looking for a blocker and takes it all the way down to the 5-yard line. There is a flag. There are two flags on the play. 68-yard return, but will it stand?
Oh, it's going to come back. But what a great individual effort there by Burke. He was all over the field.
Stutter stepping inside, trying to wait for a block. The old block in the back call.
Great individual effort, though. A lot of pressure on Atwell on that play. Just under pressure, ill-advised throw, and Burke made him pay.
Illegal block in the back during the return. Defense, 10-yard penalty, first down.
9:58 to play. Metamora with a comfortable lead back after this on the IHSA TV network. And we are back in Champaign. There's the pick by Dan Burke.
That's just the beginning because it's a journey from there. But it came all the way. You could see the block in the back there. Just a nice run back, good individual effort, but all for naught. They're back on their own 31. Good highlight, though, for him in the future. He'll show that.
He did a whale of a job against Matt Bain, Rochester's all-state receiver last week, held him to just 5 catches and 35 yards. Aaron Peters, the carry. Pickup of 3. Peters, 126 yards, Fay, 166. Here's a look at Aaron Peters' numbers. Soon to be an Eagle Scout. Outstanding young citizen Aaron Peters, who's a heck of a ball player, too. Second and 7, Fay keeps it. Oh, what a great defensive job that time. T
Tyler Clays in the ball game for Geneseo. He made a nice stop there. Boy, he read it nicely and fought off the block.
That's one of the first times that we've seen a Faye get stopped at the line of scrimmage with one guy. Usually it's taken more than one guy to get him down, but Clays did a nice job wrapping him up there. Bringing up a third. We haven't seen them in third and long situations all night. But this one actually isn't.
They punted once?
Yeah, they punted once.
For Metamora.
Yeah, the first drive of the game.
Third and long for the Redbirds. Faye will throw here. Finds Peters, and he's very close to a first down. Check that. That is not Peters. That's Sean McKee. In at receiver.
Nice job by
Faye. Defensive lineman coming in there. You don't see many defensive linemen with number 42, do you?
Yeah, just nice little action pass, good execution.
And it's a first down, Redbirds at the 41. Yeah, that's one thing we haven't really mentioned. You look at the numbers on Metamora, normally for guys that aren't very, you know, they're ball handlers, 2, 36, 42, 44 on the defensive line. They make it work. Peters with it, not much there. Gain of maybe a yard.
Well, a lot of times what they want to do is get some of their quicker guys on that defensive front. It doesn't always have to be the guys that are the biggest, but if you've got some strength and you can move, so some of those back types can play defensive line. When you're strong, you're in the weight room, and you know, you can still run. That's why these good defenses have a lot of their quick guys on the field.
Well, that's one thing Pat Ryan will tell you about this team, too. In the past, we've had big guys where we could just blow holes in the line. This year it's been more about technique, and we got to have, you know, you got to be on this side of the guy's head, or, you know, you got to be doing things just right technique-wise, and the Redbirds have done that. Peters, look at the room to run. Peters still on his feet. Down to the 20, inside the 20, where he's finally wrestled to the ground. It's Clays again, finally chasing him down after a pickup of 41 yards.
Nothing fancy there. Here's just the give. Peters, little cross trap action. Redbirds are, you see all the red shirts downfield blocking. And Peters just keeps on trucking.
We talked about him about to become an Eagle Scout. Here's another example of what kind of a guy he is. He injured his knee after his sophomore season helping someone change a tire. They had a flat tire, injured himself. He came back and was able to play. But boy, you talk about putting it on the line, that could have meant the end of a football career. Now the double handoff. And in for the score is Zach Garber. The double handoff, Richmond Burton used it to great effect last week against the Maple Leafs. Garber from 15 yards out. And it's another Metamora touchdown. They lead 40-7.
Another big play for Metamora. That's Zach Garber's second big play. He had a 33-yard gain earlier in the game, right before half, to get him a score. Now a second great play, and he gets 6 points on this one.
Well, against Central Catholic, he had two carries and scored two touchdowns. Against Pontiac, he had two carries for 98 yards. Tonight, two carries, 50 yards, and a touchdown. Making pretty good use of his time, huh?
I'd give it to him more often, I think. Come on, Coach Ryan.
You don't want to hurt his average. Brandon Van Meegen's extra point is good this time. That's his third of the night. He's now one shy of the state career record. It's Metamora up 41-7 back after this local timeout. A title game. That was the sixth rushing touchdown of the ball game, breaking the record held by Joliet Catholic. They rushed for five touchdowns in 1975. That's the same year that Metamora was winning the 3A state championship over Geneva. And Geneseo takes the kickoff. Andrew Walters, number 32, takes it out near the 30-yard line. Yeah, that's interesting that 76 and 77, when Metamora and Geneseo met, they were 3A schools way back in the day.
But then there were only five classes. So
correct.
Now we have eight. We're almost halfway through our eight games.
Here's Lemke. Just hasn't had much room to run tonight here in the second half, especially. Nice cutback move, though. And he's going across midfield. He's down to the 30, 20, and finally dragged down from behind. It's David Kinney making the touchdown-saving tackle. This time we saw that, and it was a big play early from Dan Burke. Now it's Kinney saving a touchdown. Lemke, a 70-yard run earlier in the game, this one for 59,
look
and a lot of it on his own effort.
Yeah, look at the individual effort. The play was designed to the right. He cuts it all the way back, and just a great individual effort by Lemke, likewise by Kinney to get him down.
Well, here's Atwell back to throw now. Nowhere to go, and he's brought down by Tom Bieneman, who is the sacks leader for Metamora. Well, Lemke, that's two great big plays tonight for Lemke, and Coach Johnson says he just has the ability. You don't overcoach him. He just knows what he's supposed to do. Like right there, that was all instinct.
Yeah, that was Adrian Peterson-esque right there.
41-7 our score, back after this on the IHSA TV network. Lee Hall, Greg Bradshaw, Scott Lever back in Champaign. 41-7, Metamora leading Geneseo. And we were looking at the numbers during the break, Greg. Luke Lemke, 164 yards, 123 of those have come on two carries, but another interesting number here.
Yeah, Jason Johnson, we talked about him earlier being their leading rusher. He's got seven carries for only 17 yards. They've done a really good job bottling up the fullback, the key to this wing T offense.
That was one of your keys to the game, jam up Johnson, and they have done just that. New man into the ball game is Josh Ward. So Larry Johnson going to his bench here. Josh Ward in there with the carry. And Pat Ryan will send in some subs.
Now we're starting to get in some of the guys.
Dan Burke coming out, he'll get a big hand. Jesse Mishler, another senior DB, and boy, what a year they have had. Some pretty hard-fought games against some good passing teams down the stretch. Those DBs really stepped up big. And the giver on the right side is DeLandon Hoon, number 37, a 5'9 sophomore, getting a little playing time here on the carpet.
Nice run there by Landon. It's great when these guys get in. I know it's tough right now for Geneseo, knowing that the game's out of reach, but it's really a special opportunity for some of these guys worked hard all year to get an opportunity to be in the state championship game.
First state finals appearance for Geneseo since 93. They were second back-to-back years in 92 and 93.
Timeout, Geneseo.
Geneseo will call a timeout here with 4:41 to play in our 4A state championship game. I believe this will be the first time that a 4A championship game has been won by a public school since they went to eight classes. I believe I heard that.
Interesting stat.
We'll have to double check that, but I heard that earlier today. Montini and Juliet Catholic, speaking of non-public schools, will kick things off tomorrow morning here on the IHSA TV network at 10 a.m.
Juliet Catholic goes for 14.
14, yeah.
Number 14 tomorrow if they can
14.
Win that game.
Saw them a couple of weeks ago, and they're good.
Yeah.
I would not, all due respect to Montini, but I don't think I'd bet against the toppers in that one.
That 6-8 game's going to be good.
Cary Grove and Providence. You saw Cary Grove last week.
Yeah, Cary Grove looks real good. They played my son's team, Prairie Ridge. They're real tough, undefeated.
Glenbard West, Wheaton Warrenville South in 7A, and wrapping it up, Marist against Maine South. They probably make reservations every year down here, don't they? They're
That's
always
right.
here. Great program. And a fumble on the play. The carrier was Josh Ward again, the ball carrier. We'll have to dig through that pile to see who has it. Well,
one of the Metamora players stuck around behind the ref and showed it to him. That was Brian Love. Brian Love comes up with the fumble recovery. He was in on the game-saving tackle on the two-point conversion last weekend against Rochester. He and Dane Kemp, and he comes up with the fumble recovery here. Still playing hard here in the last 4.5 minutes.
And Lee, you were correct. We just heard that Metamora will be the first public team to win since they went to the 8-class system in 2001. We had only three previous winners have been
Driscoll Catholic.
Yep, Montini and Bloomington Central Catholic.
Now this is, you know, this is, like I say, this is just kind of an old school matchup.
Yeah, it's
old school. It's one, it's single school towns, you know, the whole town's here.
Right.
And it's just, you know, it's kind of a throwback. There's Bo Geyer. We talked about him earlier. What a great job he did filling in for the Redbirds. He actually came in, filled in, and got hurt himself. And you look at the injuries that Metamora has overcome to get here. Faye had a concussion in week one, high ankle sprain in week two, and he forced him to miss a couple of games and play hurt all year. He was hit out of bounds in a game against Limestone. Peters out week eight with an ankle. Geyer, a concussion in week three. McKinney, Kemp, Birch, Tracy Love. Most of their main guys missed time with injuries, pretty significant injuries in this season. And you talk about an unlikely run. They lost eight starters, both sides of the ball. No senior linebacker, first time in 20 years. We talked about that. Battled the injuries. They didn't win the middle line eye. You know, I mean, to come here with one loss is very unusual for Metamora.
That's right. Well, the thing about it is they have a great football program, and they got guys that can come in and fill in. And, you know, I don't think there's a kid in the whole town between the age of 14 and 17 that's not out for football, so they got a lot of guys.
There's two. There's two. There's Geyer with the key. Still on his feet. Well, there's another quarterback that can run for Metamora. Geyer rushed for 518 yards, 12 touchdowns this season, and threw for 231 yards. So he saw some significant time this season. He also is a junior, and Pat Ryan says that's as much depth as we've ever had.
Two great quarterbacks. Maybe next year Geyer's at quarterback, and you might see Faye at running back. Who knows? They got two good quarterbacks.
Or vice versa. You never know. Charlie Nowotnik, a sophomore with the carry there. Yeah, that's one thing that is so amazing and just remarkable to watch, I think, one year to the next, is how the really good programs, they just keep coming back. You know, and the names change, but the teams keep coming back.
It's really a tribute to the coaching staff, because the coaching staff really knows how to teach the fundamentals of the football game. And they encourage the kids. They keep get a lot of kids out. It's really a tribute to that coaching staff, both of these teams.
Jake Ferguson with the carry. 436 rushing yards is also now for a state championship game record for the Metamora Redbirds. 440 yards and counting for the Redbirds as we hit the 2-minute mark here in our 4A state championship game, and the Redbirds have answered any doubts there were. Boy, they lost that week two game to Washington, and you know, the sky was falling in some people's minds, but here they are tonight, about to bring home another state title, the second for Pat Ryan in the last 3 years.
It's a great year for Geneseo, too. There were really not as high expectations for the Geneseo team, and that they have just overachieved. They survived throughout the playoffs, opportunistic, and really a great, great finish for Geneseo.
Here's another interesting thing I saw in the notes, where Pat Ryan has lost 5 state championship games. It's 3rd and 2 for the Redbirds. And we want to talk about all these guys that are in there getting some playing time tonight. That's Jake Ferguson again on the carry. Saw that he lost 5 state championship games more than any other coach. All 5 of those were to schools, private schools.
Right.
And the public league, or the public schools will say the private schools with no boundaries. Okay, you can have that debate. I'm not going to couldn't go any further than that. However, Pat Ryan now moves to 2-0 against public schools. Beat Forest, and now will beat Geneseo. And Pat Ryan doesn't want to talk about that kind of stuff. He says, we just go out and play the game.
Right.
That's right. We just go out and play the game. We can't control any of that stuff, and they have done that. So a state championship in 1975 under John Helmick, a state championship 2 years ago under Pat Ryan, and a state championship game. And one other thing I want to say real quickly, Greg, you talk about the great traditions, and we can't go through all the names on the sidelines of the assistant coaches. There are a number of coaches on both sides who are graduates, like the head coaches, alumni of their respective schools, out there giving back to the programs that they once played in.
That's right.
That helps as well.
That's great.
There's Pat Ryan, father of four. His son's a freshman and a pretty good player, pretty good size kid himself. There's Nick Belinsky, one of the guys that played for Pat Ryan. All the coaches, it looks like, are getting showers on the sidelines.
That's great.
And I talked to Pat Ryan. He's like, you know, you look at his record, there's some years there as the final is 41-7 Metamora. Some years there that weren't, you know, especially getting started and getting the program back up to where it was under John Helmick. He said 1995 was the big year. We weren't getting the athletes out to play football. 1995, we got a guy by the name of Andy Reeve out to play football, and that kind of got the ball rolling.
I'm sure he's here today.
He's here in spirit. Nobody's left in Metamora or Geneseo. We know that. Congratulations to Geneseo for getting here. Boy, they never quit in the playoffs getting to this point. Took advantage of every fumble and opportunity they got in the playoffs to beat some very, very good teams to get here. Metamora, likewise, some very tough games down the stretch. And I talked to several of the players, Burke and Kenny Fay, about those close games against Pontiac, Breeze, Modern Day, Rochester. How do those build your confidence? And the intestinal fortitude that those wins gave these kids, pretty evident here tonight. And boy, just running on all cylinders here tonight. The Redbirds, the big red machine, beating the green machine here tonight.
That's right. Almost 500 yards of total offense. Just domination, almost 29. Minutes of possession versus only 19 to Geneseo. Really, the stats are pretty much one-sided, although 291 yards for Geneseo. They, second half, at least they got on the board, and they did move the ball, but just couldn't seem to get into the end zone.
Boy, they got that opening touchdown for the third quarter. Got within two touchdowns, and it was all Metamora after that. 41-7 our final. The second title in the last 3 years for the Metamora Redbirds, and head coach Pat Ryan, he's downstairs with Scott Leber.
Well, Pat Ryan, you've got the Redbirds back on top once again. Are you able to enjoy this one now? I know at halftime you were still fretting about what might happen.
Well, we can enjoy it. I just don't know how to explain. This group of kids took a tremendous amount of criticism the second week of the season. And all we heard is how this group of kids had let everybody down and hadn't put in the time. So for them to experience this, I really don't know what to say. This team will always be remembered as a great character team and a very, very close-knit group. And it's all about the kids. They've done what we've asked them to do, and that's what makes it special.
Was there some inner drive that rose up after that loss that maybe inspired these guys to do this?
Well, the only thing we ever asked these kids was to be able to look themselves in the eye, each other, because you can only control that. And they looked each other in the eye, and they were accountable to each other, and that may mean more than anything.
Let me ask you about this young man I'm going to talk to here in a second, Michael Fay, 4 TDs for him. How special is this young man?
Well, he turned it on last couple weeks. He's a gamer. He'd been hurt, and he's just struggled through the year to get back to – he's just finally back to the Michael Fay that we know we have. And he played great the last 2 weeks.
Congratulations, Coach. Michael Fay is our Country Financial Services Player of the Game.
Val Kilmer.
Michael, man, 41-7. Did you ever imagine that kind of final score tonight, huh?
I know. After last week, I wouldn't think, you know, blowing teams out would be like he's like that. But, I mean, we came out ready to play. I mean, our offense did well and put up 41, had a good game.
I know you've had some ups and downs this year with injuries and all. How good did you feel physically tonight?
I felt fine. I mean, everything was healed up, and just came out here and felt fine all night.
You're listed as a quarterback, but you're a heck of a runner. Is there a big running back inside of this quarterback that loves to run with a football?
Yeah, I mean, we come from more of a running offense, so, I mean, I'm fine with running the ball. I like running the ball, and, you know, just run as hard as I can, try to get the yards, and got a great fullback next to me. I mean, it makes it easy.
A year ago, it was not a happy feeling when Metamora walked off this field. Does this help take some of that sting away?
Yeah, I mean, last year we came off, lost by 2 touchdowns. It was tough. We wanted to get back here. We got back here, and we finished it off and got the win.
All right, Michael, congratulations. Great job here tonight. All right, that's our Country Financial Services Player of the Game. Lee, back to you.
Scott, thank you very much. Did I tell you? Val Kilmer, a young Val Kilmer. Metamora wins it 41-7. Pat Ryan says, we don't have goals like winning conference, because what happens if you don't win the conference? They didn't win their conference. They win a state championship. Back after this local timeout.
Champion Metamora, please join the presenters on the awards platform. Present special medallions to the administrators, and individual awards will be presented to Coach Ryan and his team captains. We'll present this year's state championship Class 4A team trophy to the Redbirds of Metamora High School, who finished the season with a final record of 13 wins and one loss. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the awards presentation for the Class 4A championship game. The IHSA thanks you for joining your team here at Memorial Stadium and hopes you have enjoyed your visit to the University of Illinois.
So you had a chance to see the Metamora Redbirds hoist that state trophy, the third one in their school's history. While you're on commercial break, did not get an opportunity to see Geneseo pick up that second place trophy, but you do right now. Geneseo, the ninth time they were in the state finals. That is the fifth time they have finished in second place. Your Menards Hardware Trophy presentation. Welcome back to our studios here on the IHSA TV network, along with Jeff Reins from Wilmington and Jason Kirby from Sherrard. I'm Dave Bernhardt. Glad you could join us for this one. And we look back at this game and the second half. Even though the first, three, 4 minutes was all Geneseo, the rest was all Redbirds.
Yeah, it really was. And, you know, Metamora came out and just kept doing what they were doing the first half. Geneseo showed a spark there. We thought, you know, up here they get some confidence going. But Metamora came back and, you know, up front, again, boy, very impressed with the way they handled themselves up front, the way they handled the ball all night long. I know me and Coach Kirby had a little tough time seeing exactly who had the ball all night long. And I think, you know, obviously Geneseo had a tough night too defensively. But then again, nothing against Geneseo. What a great year for them to be in this position. I know it's a tough night, but my hat's off to Geneseo and Metamora tonight.
Let's take a look at those final stats here. The stats that are slanted very heavily towards Metamora, brought to you by Menards. Save big money at Menards. Those 447 rushing yards, that is one of several state records that were set here in the 4A championship ballgame. And again, you look in the Geneseo side, not too shabby numbers when you just look on the left of that column.
Yeah, no doubt. 223 yards rushing. I think going into the state finals, you'd take the fact that you were going for 269 for the day. 31 rushes, 229 yards, 5 of 10 third down conversions. That's a decent number as well. I think Geneseo has, you know, I know that their kids, as we've said earlier in the day, aren't very happy right now, but what a run. What a great season, accomplishing going to the state finals again. Titletown was there again, and they'll be back next year with a lot of underclassmen playing today.
Let's take a look at those second half highlights as we take a look at how Metamora just kept rolling it up. First of all, though, this was Geneseo, the opening drive. A pass from Michael Atwell to Colin Akers. That brought this ball down to the into scoring territory. Actually, that pass went to Luke Lemke, and then Lemke gets to finish this one off on a run around the right side. This capped an eight-play, 78-yard drive, and just like that, just a couple of minutes into the second half, this margin was cut to 21-7. But after that, all Redbirds. We talked about it at halftime. When was Aaron Peters going to break loose? Well, how about this? 48 yards. That was the fifth play of an 82-yard drive to push that score to 28-7 with 7:08 to play in the third quarter. And then why not? Michael Fay, his fourth touchdown run of the day. This was the longest of them all. 24 yards, finished off a nine-play, 65-yard drive. The score went to 34-7. And finally, we look the other way in the interceptions. Picked off this one by Brian Love. This one down deep into scoring territory for Metamora. And when they had it all said and done, they were going to punch it in from there. Again, 13 state records set in these last two games, 3A and 4A. And this just added to some of those totals. Zach Garber will take this one in from 17 yards out, and that takes us to our final score, 41-7. That a six-play, 69-yard drive, and that was the story of this game. Long drives, long possessions, not any quick strike offense from Metamora, but they just hung on to the ball all night.
Offensive line, as Coach Reen said, took care of business. And they played similar in the 4A game to the what we saw in the 3A game. They were able to convert in third and short situations when they had those. They also, their offensive line was flawless. Very few penalties. Just executed very, very well throughout the course of the night. And the other thing that Coach said moments ago, they were able to answer the score that Geneseo made at the beginning of the second half, which eliminated momentum from staying on the Geneseo side. That's what happens in the course of state title games. You have to answer, and they did.
Well, it's interesting, Jeff, because in the first moments of each half, that's very much what happened. Geneseo, in the opening drive of the game, took it all the way down inside the 10-yard line. They could not finish it off. Metamora answers, and here in the second half, the same thing. In reverse, after Geneseo does put the points on the board.
Yeah, and it's a credit to Coach Ryan and his staff and his kids. You know, we talked about it a little bit before the game. One thing I thought Metamora had a little bit of an advantage of was their kids, even though they got beat last year, were here in this environment. They've been through the grind a little bit. So when they came back this year, I thought it really showed in Mike Fay. I thought he did a great job in handling himself all night long. And, you know, you just can't, you know, you always talk about how a championships game is going to go. If you have experience, boy, what a great thing it is. Because you get down here, you're not, you know, when you get into Memorial Stadium, you know, it is big. You know, you got the big lights on you, this and that. If you've been through it once, it's a little easier to handle. I think that was a big thing to Metamora tonight.
Well, and that's the thing with Geneseo. The first time in 15 years that this storied program had made it back here, but now feet underneath them, as you said, some young players, get some things rolling back. And what a, you know, you talked about it briefly, but what a run, what a magical run in the playoffs. And that's what makes it so special for that community.
No doubt. Any run that you have in the playoffs to make it here is a magical run. If you go through and 40-point everyone, it's a magical run. If you win on the heart attack specials all the way through, it was a magical run as well. You know, any time you have the opportunity to come here and play under the last of the Friday Night Lights, then you've had a great season and you have, you know, community support and memories that you'll never forget.
You know, and I like, too, Pat Ryan was talking about how they lost that second game of the year to Washington, who ended up winning the conference. But it's, I think a lot of people have to realize this is a long season. A lot of football gets played. When you think back to that week number two, what was probably about 85 degrees out that weekend, and, right. And here we are ending up on a 32-degree night in November.
And, you know, that's everybody's goal. I mean, there's no doubt. I mean, me and Coach Kirby are glad to be here doing this tonight, but we'd rather no doubt be on that field. There's no doubt about that. But, you know, as head coaches here, you take your team from point A to point B. You see, you know, you have to make adjustments all year long, and obviously these two teams made the right adjustments to get to this point tonight, and it's a credit to both Coach Ryan and Coach Johnson. I think, you know, no doubt, particularly with these two programs, they're used to being undefeated. And for them to have a loss here or a loss there during the regular season, you know, they got to look themselves in the mirror a little bit. How can we get better? What adjustments do we have to make? And obviously to get here tonight, they made those adjustments. And two great programs, you know, laid it on the line tonight.
Final score, 41-7. Geneseo knocks off Metamora. We'll be back here at Memorial Stadium right after these words from your local sponsors. For the second time in 3 years, the Metamora Redbirds get to bring home that championship trophy, 41-7 tonight over the Maple Leafs from Geneseo back at Memorial Stadium, a very chilly Memorial Stadium. As everybody files out of here, they'll sweep this thing up and get ready for four games starting tomorrow at 10 o'clock. And they'll start right here on the IHSA TV network. Another 12 hours of high school football coverage as we will crown champions in 5A through 8A as the Metamora still celebrating. Make sure everybody gets a hand on that trophy along those sidelines. And we looked into the stands. They're thinning out. But, boy, the sound, the emotion, we talked about it in our pregame about how it was going to be, and it will be the same way tomorrow when more storied programs come here to Champaign. Montini takes on Joliet Catholic at 10 o'clock. Joliet Catholic with 13 state championships. Providence and Cary Grove, they're both back for the same in the same year since 2004. Providence won a state title that year. Cary Grove finished second. Providence looking for their 10th state championship. And then you punch it into the 7A game, Wheaton-Warrenville South. They have their permanent reservations here in Champaign, and this year they'll take on Glenbard West. And then Maine South will look to repeat in Class 8A as they will take on Marist, making their second appearance overall in the state finals. But back to the two communities that were involved here tonight, Geneseo and Metamora. We talked about that in the opening, how these two communities got wrapped up. What a great atmosphere there was tonight in terms of the sound and in the feeling in the stadium.
It really was. I think, in dealing with that, talking to Coach Kirby, and that's the goal. You know, that's something that you'd strive for as a head coach, is to try to get that kind of community support. We both coach in schools where that support's there. We're very lucky to have that. But to see that many people come and to support your team, isn't that what high school sports is all about? Not only do you bring athletes together to work all season long, but you bring communities together to work all season and to establish relationships that just don't last tonight. It's going to last well past tonight.
Well, and when I was in a neighboring district to Geneseo, that was my motto. I mean, we would tell the kids all the time, we want to build this program to the level that Geneseo is in terms of support and community belief and people involved. And the things that they did, we tried to do. We tried to pattern a number of our things because we wanted the experience for our kids to be similar to what it was with them. I mean, if you go to a game at Jeff's place, that's an experience. And we wanted those same sort of things. So you pattern the things that you do after those programs that are successful so they can have the types of experiences that those kids got to have today with those wonderful crowds from those communities.
Well, in fact, you were remarking, I think we were off camera at the time, you were talking about how you're going to take films from this game and this game and this game and take them back to your schools to show, the field's 100 yards long here in Champaign, and we can do some of the same things some of these state title teams did.
Yeah, I think you can. I think one thing you can take, particularly from the 3A and the 4A games today, is I think you'll see in a lot of other games the ball being passed around quite a bit. Boy, it's proven with Stillman and with Metamora, with Geneseo, that running the ball can be a great way to get yourself into a state championship game also. There's not one certain way to get here. There's no doubt about that. And so you always try to take a little bit from the championship teams, from the teams that get down there. And, it's a learning experience, not just for the kids, but also for the coaches.
We had several games today, four to be exact. We started at 10 a.m. Here are your state champions. Four of them have been crowned in a low-scoring game, and when you look at some of the other scores, how low-scoring it was. Tuscola 14-7 over Lexington. Lexington has their unbeaten season come to an end. And on the other side, Morrison, we talked about first time they've ever been in the state championship games in any sport, 36-14 over Maroa Forsyth. Stillman Valley picked up their fourth title in four tries with a 52-22 win over Tolono Unity. And then, of course, it was tonight, Metamora at 41-7. And I think this is, as we look through those scores and we think back to 10 o'clock this morning, almost 12 hours ago, all the varying styles that the folks, whether they're down here in Champaign or whether they watch here in the IHSA TV network, they can be exposed to all the different styles of football from all over this state from top to bottom.
What a day of football. Starting with the first game, what a great football game that we saw, a defensive battle. And then as the day progressed, seeing a number of different styles, as you said, that leads to itself to being high school football. Not everything has to be the same. There are a number of different ways to get a state championship won, and we saw that today.
Lee Hall had the call in the 2A and 4A games. Let's go back to he and Greg Bradshaw.
All right, guys, thanks a lot. Well, you talk about differing styles all day. A couple of teams that had similar styles here in this 4A state championship. A couple of teams, as we talked about during the game, Greg, that were unlikely teams to get here. You know, Metamora had lost during the regular season. They played some really tough, hard-fought games and got the wins in the last month in very close ball games. Geneseo had been behind in games and got fumble recoveries and fumbled to themselves for a touchdown in the semifinal game. So, it's funny how the ball bounces and how things work out over the course of a long season.
Well, I think that's the exciting thing about high school football. It builds character in kids. And, you know, talk about what are we really here for. It's fun to watch football. It's fun to score touchdowns. But these guys learn so much about not giving up and overcoming odds. And both of these teams we saw here tonight, it wasn't easy for them. They had to work hard to get here. And just a real testament to their character, their coaching staff, staying with the kids, bonding together. That's what sports are about, and they really got a chance to experience this year.
And that's one thing Pat Ryan talked about, too, was getting to this point in spite of all that, his team overcoming deficiencies, knowing they had to work, knowing they were smart enough to know they had to work to overcome those and get here anyway. And Aaron Peters maybe typifies what the coaches were just talking about. Here's a guy that he's their leading rusher, but he also carries out block. He takes great pride in blocks, carries out every fake too. Doesn't just kind of stop and pull back on a fake. He carries that out too. So the offense is a little bit more diversified, a little bit more tougher to read, as they talked about trying to find out where the ball is. So we see those things play out here tonight as Metamora wins our 4A state championship. And we'll be back in Champaign after this local timeout. We welcome you back to Memorial Stadium here. The 4A championship game has come to a close. Metamora 41-7 winners over Geneseo. We welcome you to the IHSA TV network, and we welcome you to the Geneseo Maple Leafs. And head coach Larry Johnson, Jr. And Larry, I know you look at that score. It was obviously not what you had in mind coming in here. But what was it about Metamora that really was so dominating for them tonight?
Well, I think the big thing is it started up front offensively and defensively. And they did a tremendous job of controlling the line of scrimmage. And then obviously with the quarterback and the running back, their fakes were so good. They just executed well. I mean, you know, I think the best teams are those guys that run a few simple plays, and then you can just execute them to the best of their ability. I think that's what happened today.
On the other side, defensively or offensively for you, seemed as if you were forever in third and long.
Yeah, we didn't do a good enough job on first down to get us some yards, and we can't play, you know, in long yardage situations. We can't put ourselves into bad situations with penalties either. You know, we had some couple things that would go our way a little bit, and then we get bogged down with a penalty, or in the first half there we didn't get anything out of our first possession or whatever it was. But you know, kudos to Metamora. I mean, they did a really good job, and they're a really good team, and obviously they're really well coached. I mean, they deserve to win it today.
Jason,
you guys had a wonderful run through the course of the playoffs and through the season as well. As far as the playoffs was concerned, what was the most exciting thing that took place through the course of your playoff run that you'll remember the most?
I think beating Richmond Byrne at home. Richmond Byrne beat us the year before 21-0. We kind of had to redeem ourselves. We beat them last week to make it to the finals.
Yeah, that was a great game as well, and you guys had to fight back from some adversity in that game. So I'd say that is something definitely to remember. Certainly with the community spirit that you guys had going on as well through the course of the week was something that we touched on as well.
Hey, Colin, you battled hard tonight. There's no doubt about that. Can you talk to me a little bit and talk to the people out there a little bit about what you thought about the team as a whole? A couple words that come to mind about how kids have come together during the year.
Yeah, you know, our team is a great family. You know, we've always come close, and we have a great bond between the players, and we've learned to never hit the panic button, you know, when we're down and when it's down in the dumps, you know, we can be able to come back, stay calm, and just do what we need to do. And that's the great thing about our team is just the family bond that's there.
Well, I know during the season, you know, there's probably some ups and downs, but the way you guys came together during the season is a great example to everyone, and congratulations to everybody here.
Jason, I think you have Luke Lemke standing behind you.
Yeah,
there.
Luke, your school and your football program has such great history. What was it like playing for Geneseo as a high school athlete?
It's a huge honor to play here. We have a great program here, great coaching staff, huge tradition. The community supports us 100%. It's just really fun to play here.
Well, gentlemen, congratulations on the way you did support your community. You say you got community support, but you supported your community. You brought the Green Machine out here to Champaign tonight. Congratulations to you for a great year. We'll step aside. When we come back, we'll wrap things up from Memorial Stadium. Day one just about in the books. Nobody's home here in Champaign as Memorial Stadium has emptied out four games of high school football completed. Four state champions have been crowned. Dave Bernhardt back with you here high atop Memorial Stadium right after the 4A championship game. Metamora claims their third state title in 10 attempts and the second in the last 2 years, 41-7 over Geneseo. And this caps a great day of high school football. Four champions crowned today. We have four more coming your way tomorrow. It will start at 10 o'clock. Montini and Joliet Catholic, followed by Providence and Cary Grove. Then at 4 o'clock tomorrow afternoon, it will be the 7A championship game. Glenbard West taking on Wheaton Warrenville South. And then we'll wrap it up in Class 8A, Maine South against Marist. We hope you can join us for that one. For all of my partners up here in the booth today, for Jason Kirby, along with Jeff Reintz and Rich Thompson, I'm Dave Bernhardt. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow right away at 10 o'clock, another 12 hours of football.